We just want you to let the Spirit of the Lord come upon you. The presence of the Lord is here to heal you, to save you from whatever problems you may have or whatever issues you may have. Some people deal with recurrent sin, addiction, harassment, torment, depression, all sorts of varieties of things. Jesus, come save you from them. Hallelujah. Jezukoje Rimandeya. Some people just deal with a disappointment. They just always trying to get something and it seems that they can't have it, even in the things of the Spirit. Disappointment will keep you from moving in what God has for you. You can't be disappointed and move in faith. Tonight, just let God be God. Let God be God. Just let God be God. He's here. I promise you that as real, fix this, man. I promise you that as real as the Bible is, and as real as what God says in His Word, I promise you, God is here. I promise you. As real as what He says in His Word. I promise you, it just as real as what He says in His Word, just as real as the Bible is, He's here. He's right here. Christ Jesus is here. Holy Ghost is here. Mande risandolo boko yamana seya. Now, all you have to do is believe. If you don't believe, if you refuse to believe, then there's no way that Father can do anything. And right, a lot of times it is just, I don't know what it is, man. Because I walk up to people I've never met before, you know, and they pull off the hearing aid and get healed. Just there, right there. It's because a real big part of it is because they don't know who I am. They just think I'm a man of God. You know what I'm saying? Then I'm not familiar to them. And so ultimately I come to them and they think Jesus came to them. Then people, and it's the same way with the Word of God. People at first are excited about the Word of God because it's the Word of God, and then all of a sudden it becomes like commonplace to them. Then they can't receive nothing. You can't be that. Listen, Papa wants us to be His church. Father wants us to be His church. I do not by myself determine that this church can be His church. You determine that. You determine whether or not you're going to allow apostles and prophets and teachers, the gifting of it. And after that, the working of miracles and the gifts of healing. You have to recognize that. You have to recognize that you decide your spiritual condition, your spiritual hunger, your spiritual appetite determines whether or not you're going to flow and operate in the word of knowledge. The word of wisdom, discerning spirits, where you're going to function in the Holy Ghost, whether you're going to carry an anointing. Because the reality of it is there's very few people on the planet carrying anointing. And it's not God's fault. It's because we get discouraged, we get disappointed, we get distracted. That's just the D's. I think I could go through the A's, the B's, the C's. You know what I'm saying? And list them all out. I'm just going to have to stop it. We're just going to have to believe God. We're going to have to let God be God, people. You're going to have to let God be. He's here. As real as His Bible is His Bible, He's here. Not only because He says it in His Word, but I can feel Him. He's here right now with me. I can feel His presence, which is an awesome and wonderful thing. It's better than anything, better than life itself. Thank you, Jesus. Man, it's just a beautiful sign out there. Praise God for that. Thank you, Jesus. And it got painted and it looks better. It's amazing. We're just so thankful for that. Everybody that's involved in that, we're just so blessed. Everybody that works to help keep the church clean and things and the faithful to come, that's all a great blessing. But we could have church in a brush harbor. We could have church out there in that parking lot and it'd be far more glorious if everybody's willing to be full of the Holy Ghost. You understand? We can all get up in those trees and sit in those trees and have church. We could all sit down in the parking lot and have church. It's about whether or not you're going to let the Holy Ghost flow. And you're going to have to, people, you're going to have to deal with this now. You're going to have to, there is enough anointing here to supercharge you and break you out of you. You, the young, worst enemy. That's what Jesus said, you need to deny yourself. People don't realize that. Once you recognize that you are in the way, you'll gladly deny yourself from that day on. You'll go, I'm not going to be in the way. It's just too good to walk in the anointing. It's just too wonderful to be used of God. Hallelujah. It's just too wonderful to see devils go out of people and completely delivered. It's too wonderful to see those who are on their way to an eternity without God completely set free and delivered and instantly. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You know, we got in the taxi cab, and it's just really been working on me because I think it's where a lot of people are stuck. Got in a taxi cab going to the airport in Portland, and I got in the car, and immediately I knew that the person that was driving was a Muslim, and he told me that. I said, "Where are you from?" He told me he was from a nation just below Morocco, and at first I thought, you know, I might talk to him a little bit about Islam, and then the Spirit of the Lord said, "No, you just talk to him about me." And so after talking, and he had gave us about a 30-40 minute ride. I can't remember what it was. And I began to talk to him, and after about, I don't know, maybe after about 20 minutes or so, he said, "Well, what if a person can never attain to that level?" Because I was just talking to him about walking with God, walking in the Spirit, having Christ Jesus on the inside of you. I said, no, you missed the whole point. The whole point's a free gift. The whole point is yours instantaneously, in a moment, instantly. He said, "All that instantly?" Yeah. And, you know, I thought to myself while I was telling him, I was like, you know, don't be too concerned that you didn't understand that, because the majority of church don't even understand that. They call upon the name of the Lord Jesus and then fail to realize how easy it is to live the life of Jesus. If there's anything that's got to be heard throughout the United States of America and the world, I don't know so much about China, Asia, and the things that are going on in different places where revival is just happening, move of God just now taking place. It's a fresh wind of the power of God, and they don't have all the other alternatives, and you know, and there's, but here in the United States, the Western world at any rate, people are going to have to understand God's called us to live the life of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now you think that might be a humdrum life update right now. It's the best thing's ever happened. It's joy unspeakable and full of glory. Somebody said, "Must you be happy all the time?" Must you? Must you? Must you walk around in peace that passes understanding? Must you? Man, I tell you right now, people say, "Well, you know, I'm going to decide what I'm going to do and I make my own decisions." No, you don't make any decisions. You don't. Because if you made the decisions, you'd be rich, happy, blessed. Everybody would like you, and you'd like everybody. You understand me? And anybody who didn't do that would be totally insane. You know what I'm saying? You don't make the decisions. You are under the yoke of depression and sadness and sorrow and broken relationship and strife and envy. That's all demonic realm that people have never really understood how to break free from, because they've never simply understood how to live the life of Jesus, because that's the only means to break free. And you know, when I was here last Sunday night, I was talking to you about being bound to the Word and bound to the Spirit. See, that's the living Word. It's like the Lord has caused, the Lord God, He has caused the fire to be lit. Take the sacrifice and bind it with cords to the horns of the altar. Just as Abraham took and bound Isaac, there's no more will. You have no more will. You might get scared. It might be, you know, uncomfortable. It might be too challenging. You might want to run, but you can't. You bound, man. You tied. You tied up. I want out of here. Nobody's here to listen. You tied. You tied up. And now you begin to understand you consecrated to that realm. It's your will. You voluntarily remain tied. But, I mean, to see yourself bound to a covenant now to be a living sacrifice. I mean, God's begging us. God, I beseech you therefore, brethren. That's Jesus talking. Somebody said, that's Paul. It's Jesus. It wasn't Jesus. It wasn't God in the Bible. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, present yourself a living sacrifice. That ain't up running around somewhere doing your own thing. That's bound with cords to the horns of the altar to be an offering unto God, so that Father may show his glory in the midst of a dark world. He makes his light to shine in the midst of the sacrifice. He steals the plague. There's somebody to stand between the dead and the living. People don't realize this, but Jesus Christ is about to come and change everything. Everything's about to change. You better change, because it's going to change. I'm telling you right now. Everything's going to change, so you better get to change it. And the change you want to make is the change that the Word of God describes. And when you sit in a place like this where the fire of God's Word constantly going forward, you don't have no excuse. People down the road, they got all kinds of excuses. All they're getting is dictionary and a few other things. They're not getting a lot. They're getting the daily read. You know, the people's opinion. You're getting the Word of God over here. The glory of heaven's up, as one person said, the glory of heaven's up in this place. It's true. Power of God, I mean, I'll tell you right now. The fire of God rests upon me right now in such an amazing way. I'm amazed I can even stand up and walk around and talk in English. Hallelujah. And Father has this for everyone. Jesus is the great baptizer. He baptizes in the Holy Ghost and fire. It's not a fairy tale. It's not a fairy tale. It's about time people start living this realm. God has given to us the expressions of his glory that are supposed to be coming out of us. That's not some little small expression. Oh, I was born with a little talent. What's your talent? Oh, my gifting is prayer. What's your gift? God has given his life to us. It's supposed to be gushing out of us like rivers of expression. Give me a break. I mean, I'm tired of all this man-made doctrine. I'm going to tell you right now, if the Bible was like men describe it, I wouldn't want nothing of it. You know what I'm telling you? If it was like, if what we have in God is what religion expresses, I'd be like the rest of the world. Not interested. Papa's raising up people who's willing to live the life of Jesus Christ. Who's willing to let God be God. You're not going to deal with your problems until you let Jesus live. You're not going to be different until you let Jesus live. And that's the acceptance of a gift. That's because you encounter him. I'm always amazed at the power of God. When I go away and was in a meeting in Birmingham, Alabama. And I'm just amazed. I think I must be a different person. Because I barely walk up to somebody and start talking, and the preacher with big churches, and the power of God strikes them, and things change, and they're radically changed. And then people get accustomed, I don't know, to living in the fire of God that they don't even know they're under the glory cloud. They don't even know it's a fire by night. They don't even know that man has fallen from heaven. Don't even know it. And they're wondering, oh God, where are you at? What are you doing? When can I? No, now, tonight, just let God be God. Tonight, just recognize that he's here. Tonight, understand that the authority of heaven is available. Father, this is Father's idea, not yours. He's begging you. You're not begging him. If I could get people, just believe that God's actually begging you right now. Please let me move in your life. Please let me show you my glory. There's a lot of doubt in the way, people. There's a lot of doubt. There's a lot of unbelief. There's a lot of folks saying they're going and staying at home. You know what I'm saying to you? Do you hear me? They say they're going to go, but they stay at home. One way or the other. And it's about time that we get some people get radical. And say, well, I'm going to be a part of the church. You think a pastor's one that makes it whether it's going to be a glorious church or not. It does not. It's a body. God has given us his glory that all the world may see that we dwell in them. Now, you listen, you aren't going to be able to participate with the oneness that God described through the Apostle Paul moving in the Spirit as the body of Christ in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, until you one with them. You have to have John 17, 22, 23 happen to you, because you're never going to be one in the body of Christ with each other until you one with them. And there's and the only barrier there is between you right now, where you at right now, and being one with God is your doubt and unbelief and uncertainty. If somehow we can break you past that, hey, nobody can decide that but you. Because, and I've seen it over and over again, because I've read the whole Bible. Then I read it again, then I read it again, then I read it again, and I read it again, and I read it again. Somebody said to Ann today on the plane, she's reading the Bible. Oh, you're reading that book? Yeah, I've been there, done that. It's a good book to read. Yeah, I bet. I bet you have. No, you come taste and see the Lord is good. Lately, He invites us into a realm of divine power and divine glory that there's no way that you walk in there and then act so casual about it and just leave and say, that was pretty cool. Been there, done that. Now you captivated. Something's going to happen to you now. The problem is people just waiting out on the outside, the agonizing about coming in. You need to come in. Somebody said, are you questioning my experience? Absolutely. Absolutely question your experience. If your experience don't look like you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire like they did on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, you should question your experience. If you do not have rivers of living water as Jesus Christ described in John chapter 7, you should question your experience. If you do not have the fruits of the Spirit and the glory of God in your life, you should question your experience. If you have not yet judged that one died for all so that all are dead, that we henceforth no longer live unto ourselves but unto Christ, you should question your experience, because you got something different than the Word of God describes. It's true. I'm telling you tonight, God, the Father, has given you an opportunity. You have an opportunity. You can go and you can spend your life making money for yourself. You can spend your life trying to get more groceries in the cupboard. You can spend your life trying to get a promotion at your job. You can spend your life trying to get a new car that's going to rust and look ugly inside of 10 years. Less than that, five. Less than that, two. You can do all these things. I mean, and it's so pathetic, because you could have lived in the glory of His beauty and splendor. You could have been a miracle worker. You could have been something far more than Elijah, something far more than Enoch, something far more than Moses. You could have been just like Jesus. One with Him, functioning in His glory. People say, well, I'm not Jesus. Well, He wants you to be. He wants you to be in Him. In fact, He wants you to be so much like Him that He wants you to do more than He did. He wants you to do these works and greater works. And He says, anyone who believes these works. And it ain't something subjective. It's turning water into wine. That's these works. It's opening up the eyes of the blind. That's these works. It wasn't a music ministry. It wasn't a prayer meeting only. He did them. But that really wasn't what He was talking about when He was saying these works. He walked on the water. These works. He multiplied the loaves and the fishes. These works. He revealed heaven's glory. These works. He raised the dead. These works. It's about time we stop finding excuses for ourselves. Huh? Amen? And we just start pressing into greater depths of miracles and signs and wonders. People compromise all the time. Man, they get all under the yoke of fear and they run off to the doctors. And then, you know, they wonder why they can't move in miracle ministry. Because you're not willing to be tried and proven. You're not willing to come all the way up to the place where it costs you everything. Paul said, I've suffered the loss of everything, all things. Can it be done? Somebody then breaks into the conversation and says, are you saying we can't go to the doctors? Go, for heaven's sakes, go. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about people who want to move on in to the glory of heaven. I'm talking about people who want to stop just being where it is they're at and go ahead and do what Jesus said we could do and live like Jesus said we live and take a hold of divine health and take a hold of divine strength and divine perfection and divine provision. Everybody all excited about God going to provide some money for them. How about God going to provide some signs and wonders for you? How about God going to provide some supernatural working of the Holy Ghost through you? How about God going to give you some omnipotence? I like to say things to people, shock people, and then prove it to them that what I just said is absolutely what God said. Paul said, be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. And I don't know of any more omnipotent statement than that, because that's every bit of power he's got. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus said, I'm going to send the promise of the Father. You shall receive power. Hallelujah. From on high. What kind of power comes from on high? It's God power. My goodness gracious. It's about time we get disappointed with ourselves. About time we see how big of a problem self is so that we'll be happy about jumping up and down happy about denying it. Amen. So that Father can do the things he wants to do through our lives. It won't take long. You start being the church and the place will be, people will be wrapped around the building trying to get in here. It would take long. You start moving like the church. People sitting around waiting for somebody else, praying somebody else. A revival. You want revival? Go lock yourself in a room. Get down on your knees and pray. Draw a circle around you. Get down on your knees and say, oh, God, send revival in the midst of this circle. And things begin to change. That's what I did. That's why I live in the glory. That's why I live in it day in, day out. That's why when we pray, people get healed, especially ourselves, beginning with us. Hallelujah. That's why we live in divine health and divine provision. That's why we live in the divine blessing of God. That's why we live in the favor of the Lord. That's why we live in the good graces of God and the mercy of God. That's why we find ourselves being who we are in him. Huh? It's simply because we're living in it. We're living in what he gave us. We're not living in what we earned. We just stepped into the experience of what he gave us, and then when you step into the experience of what he gave you, you want more. What does that mean? That means you are in agreement with God now. Ha ha. Now participating with him, you are wide open to receive everything he's given. You get to continually drink, and when you continually drinking, you got a continual rivers flowing out of you. And you know, I'm just telling you right now, if all you got is a fire hose of glory coming out of your being, you should be highly disappointed with your experience in God. Because God didn't talk about no fire hose experience. Somebody said, well, he did say about a bubble up and a wellspring. Well, what does a wellspring look to you like? Huh? Did that look like a little trickle? What is a wellspring? Is that 35 gallons a minute for you, 350 or 3,500 or 35,000 or 350,000 gallons per minute or 3,500,000? How big is that wellspring in your mind? Because it's got to graduate into rivers eventually. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you get into a wellspring, and I want you to understand, it won't take you long, and you're going to say, where's that river? This is good enough. It's so good. I got to have more. And it won't take much more hunger than that. That's about it. That's about it. I got to have a drink. That's about as much hunger as you need. About as much faith as you need. Oh, where's that drink at, Lord? Where can I be now filled? People want to live. People are happy. They come to church and are happy to live all day long without the anointing of the Holy Ghost, without the manifest presence of Jesus, without this beautiful clothing of heaven that brings joy unspeakable, this flow of the presence of the Lord that brings this wonderful divine love and these gushings of his divine presence that, I mean, adjectives fail to describe them, but we get it out of goodness and kindness and all those things that God used in terms of adjectives and like love and joy and whew. You can't live in that and then just shut it off. I'm done now. I've had enough joy for today. I've had enough love for today. I've had enough peace for today. I've had enough power of God being manifest in my life. I've had enough goodness. I don't need no more goodness. Turn it off. That's nonsense. That's nonsense. So you have to figure out what on in heaven's name is wrong with you. You have to figure out what in heaven's name is wrong with you. That you would go whole weeks without the moving of God. I mean, we didn't have Wednesday night service. Some people wouldn't have a move of God from except from Sunday to Sunday. And that takes about half the meeting to get even something started. We got to almost pull teeth, you know. You know what I'm saying? It's hectic. You hear what I'm saying to you? By the end of the meeting, power of God, somebody said to me, said, you know, the offerings are really low. And then in their church, they said the offerings are really low. I said, you receive offerings then at the beginning of the meeting? Oh, yeah. I said, well, you just don't want to do that. People all whacked out and messed up at the beginning of the meeting. Wait till the end of the meeting. Then they're liberated a little bit. They'll go ahead and give out of the spirit instead of giving out of the, you know, out of all their frustration. And then verse said, I knew that was the secret. I knew that was what we needed to do. And, you know, some people just go ahead and they begin to preach long just on, you know, they preach and minister on offering for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. I mean, it depends on how hard the cases are. Until there's a moving of the Holy Ghost. Well, why do the men of God who are anointed have to labor so to get God's people even to flow enough to be able to become giving? Just become enough, a little, enough influenced by the Holy Ghost. They are stingy quit being stingy for like about an hour. You know what I'm saying? Just enough. We ain't even gotten into generosity yet. We just got enough of being just touched by the Holy Ghost that all of a sudden you begin to be liberated just a little bit. Well, I want to give. What's up? What's up with that? People, I'm telling you right now, the responsibility is upon your shoulders. You're going to give an account for it. Because you're willing to live without the moving of God in your life. You're willing to live without the fire of God in your life. You're willing to live whole days, whole weeks. I dare say there's people who've lived whole months, even longer than that. There are people who come into church, and it's probably the worst thing of all. I mean, listen, it's tiring for me to travel. We've been all over the map in the past week. And now there's also, I mean, there's continually more invitations now in America. And it could get to the point to where that, you know, what we just did this week is just what we do. And we could be here maybe on Sunday night. But I'm willing to do it because people are suffering from a lack of knowledge. People are so busted up. Here you sit under the Word of God. I mean, you can sit under the Word of God long enough to make your choice. You know what I'm saying? You've heard it all. I'm going to go. You know, God needs to tell everybody else. Other people need to have an opportunity. There needs to be a call. There needs to be people who understand these things, declaring these things with an anointing then to see it happen. I mean, it's one thing if you stand and you declare them and there's no anointing. You have no anointing to back it up, to bring that realm of heaven for those who are desperate, because there's a lot of people, they don't know anything about flowing in the Holy Ghost. We went into one meeting and there was a person there that, you know, was described to me as this person is very hard. I don't want to tell you his occupation. His occupation made him very hard, very callous, very resistant to anything. And I think probably after about 2 minutes, the language of the Holy Ghost was coming out of him as rich as it comes out of me. Why? He didn't know who I was. He just thought I was a man come representing Jesus. And that all he had to do was just go ahead and recognize God was there and he didn't have it all. That's about it. We did the same thing. You read the Bible too many times. You read the Bible too many times without doing it. Read the Bible so many times that it just an old hat. It don't mean nothing. It's something way off somewhere in the future. I remember the first time you read it. Wow! You mean I can do? Wow! Look at what Jesus did here. Whoa! I can do that. I want that. Fire! Fire like from heaven. Whoa! Where do I have that at? Now it's like you just mumble.
And he baptized you with the fire, Holy Ghost and fire. And then, amen.
People, we're going to have to get, we're going to have to go back to our first love. If there's any, we're going to have to go back to first love. You're going to have to start over because you messed up. You took a wrong turn. When you find out you're taking a wrong turn, it ain't working, what do? Turn around. Go back to where you were last, knew for certain of where you were at. And it really isn't that hard tonight, dear people. It's just recognizing that God is God. Just recognizing that God is in the place, that the anointing is here. You can have it right now. You gotta quit living in disappointment, discouragement, unrealized expectation, hope deferred. Because I believe that that's where people are looking for a man. I don't have a man. Why do you need a man? You got Jesus Christ. You got the Holy Ghost. He's, I just. And all these excuses, it's got to stop. It's got to stop. There's got to be a glorious church. There's got to be a people who are going to be willing to participate with the church. Otherwise, the world's not going to see a light. When God placed a light within the midst, just forget about all the sermonizing. Start flowing in the Holy Ghost, because the Holy Ghost will reveal the Word. That's what He's done. He's come to reveal the Word, Christ Jesus, the living Word. Hallelujah. And then all of a sudden the sermons, we're only supposed to be preaching sermons. I'm going to preach the Word of God because it's living, it's spirit and it's life. But I'm going to preach the Word of God with the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. I'm going to speak the Word of God with the authority of the Holy Ghost that will change you. But you can't sit there all resistant, thinking you know something, all smug, or all caught away in some disappointment or some doubt or unbelief, or it ain't working for me. What ain't working for you? God ain't working for you? That is a wonder. God Almighty somehow can't work on your behalf. I would reevaluate that if I were you. I would make you the problem. You aren't working for God. He's responding. It's you that's not responding. You hear what I'm telling you? And dear people, you're just going to have to understand this. You got to get out of wrong expectations. It's about getting a hold of that which Father has provided. Quit acting like somehow you got to earn it. What if I can't ever come to this level? You missed the point. It's a free gift. He's here. He's really here. And He wants to prove Himself to you. And all that it just takes is a little bit of cooperation, a little bit of obedience. I learned there are two kinds of imaginations. There's the imaginations that you have about the world around you and about how people think about you and how bad things are going to get. Huh? Because you got wrong thinking. It's thinking that is under the prince of the power of the air. It's thinking that comes from the culture that you were raised in. It's thinking that comes from the mindset of a human world. Then there's another kind of imagination. And it comes from the thinking that the Word of God inspires. You get the Word right, and the Word governs you, and it produces the right kind of thinking, which produces the right kind of believing. And now you got yourself some good imagination. And I've discovered that the people who are really good at imagining the Word of God in their life, that they see a crippled person and they're imagining this person's going to get up because they're the one anointed by God to go and do it. And they're so radical about their imagination that they're over there doing it before they thought twice about it. Well, everybody else is sitting there trying to think it through. Oh, well, let's have a prayer meeting. Oh, God. And really what they should be saying is, we don't believe a word that you said in your word, and we don't think that we could at all have any impact upon this person in this crippled chair, but we thought we would just go ahead and check in with you anyways. Can you hear me? Uh-oh. Somebody's telling the truth. Somebody's exposing it. Let's get out of here quick before we're infected by it. And that's about the modern response. You watch what God's going to do. He's raising up some people some young people, some old people that have got a wild imagination about God's word and living out the life of Jesus and doing what God commanded us to do. They got a wild imagination. They can see themselves walking on the water. They see themselves raising the dead. They see themselves pulling people out of wheelchairs. They see themselves speaking and God answering with an audible voice. They see themselves having a conversation with Jesus. They see themselves talking to a group of people on a street corner and seeing every one of them come under Holy Ghost conviction and break in the presence of the Lord and begin to sob uncontrollably and then see the Spirit of the Lord come upon them, baptized with Holy Ghost and fire all inside of 5 minutes. And I can just see some of you just sitting there like this. I'm afraid of that. That's scary. Could that possibly ever happen? And then you try to imagine in your world how that's going to happen. And you stuck. You got to imagine in God's world how it's going to happen. You got to imagine His Word how it's going to happen. You got to imagine by His Holy Ghost how it's going to happen. You got to, with total abandonment, take off and start flying in the realms of glory and understand, wait a minute, I've been given something from heaven that looks just like Jesus. I'm not going to sit around feeling sad anymore because I didn't get the money I wanted and I didn't get the husband I wanted or the wife I wanted or whatever the problem is. You quit imagining in your world and the framework of your ideas and your beliefs. You start imagining in what God said. Start thinking His thoughts. You start imagining a conversation with Him instead of a conversation with a human being. You start imagining being up in heaven instead of being in some kind of crisis. People are negative. Did you know you're pretty negative? Left to yourself, you're pretty negative. Left to yourself, the world is going to end tomorrow. Left to yourself, you're already imagining how that the Russians are creeping up on the outside of the international waters and about to launch some nuclear warheads, and we're so asleep because of somebody's problem that it's going to all happen and we're all dead. Don't worry about it. You'd be dead anyways. Don't even worry about it. Doesn't even matter. Just make sure that you're ready to go to heaven. Somebody said to me on the plane today, they said, well, when do you think the end of the world is going to come? I said, well, I don't really know, but I know when your end's going to come. And my end's going to come pretty soon. So it really don't matter when the end of the world is going to come. Are you ready for your end? Are you ready to stand there and say, Father, I went for you. I don't know that I would be so quickly. If you haven't done it so much. You know what I'm saying? I want Jesus to come, but my goodness gracious, I got more to do. I was telling somebody, we went into Nepal, and we've seen every kind of miracle in Nepal except for limbs grow, and I don't know that we raised the dead. I mean, we raised people up that were in comas. So my work's not done there yet. I got to go back and finish the job. There's some people running around, no legs, pushing themselves on the street corners. Those guys got to get some legs. There is a place where they continually offer the dead bodies to Shiva. They're in Kathmandu and go stand over there in line as they're bringing the dead across. Say, come on, bring them over here first. Up! I mean, we've had so many good, great, greater works dreams. I mean, we have them in our dreams. We need to have awake dreams. Ruthie Anna was telling me how she had this dream. She was preaching in Saudi Arabia, and they took a sword and they cut her head off, and she caught it. It was flying and put it back on and continued to preach. That's a greater works dream. A friend of mine was in Indonesia, and he stuck a stick in the ground. He was with a head utter. So he stuck a stick in the ground. He grabbed one of their shrunken heads. He stuck it on top of the stick and said, I command you to live. And the person raised up from the dead. That shakes things. There's a greater works dream. You got to start dreaming while you're awake now. Instead of being stuck in your little office doing your little whatever it is you're typing out. For whatever little meager amount of money somebody's giving you. Enough to keep you starving. Enough so you come back tomorrow. It's about time to recognize God to provide better for you than some boss like that. God to provide better for you than what you've been thinking and dreaming in an earthly realm. And and this is really what Paul's saying, don't set your affections on things above. Don't get your dreams and your imaginations and the things that you desire and want and passionate about on earthly things, get them on things above. Don't set him on earthly things. And we got him set on earthly things. Wonder why we can't receive the word of God. Just the word of God's going forth right now with power. It's going forth with the ability to change right now. Huh? You have to be changed. We have to be changed. We got to want it. And then it's not good enough just to want it. You got to believe it's available. And then you don't have to put in a year to get it. It's not retirement. It's available. It's available. Not 2 minutes from now. Right now. Now, I walked in here exhausted, tired, weary. No sooner did I say, Holy Spirit, I yield myself to you. Power of God came upon me. Of course, I mean, I've been flowing in the Holy Ghost all day. I've been about the master's business. And yesterday, and day before yesterday, and day before that, and day before that, and day before that, and day before that, and day, week, month, year. You can't be offline doing your thing, thinking you're going to have a relationship with Jesus. If there's one thing I want to start seeing people do is recognize that what, you know, it's like when that young girl came up with you the other day. I saw her uncertainty. I saw her unwillingness to be crucified with Christ and have a whole brand new life. She wanted to come up and get a Jesus, a culturally relevant Jesus that could still go to the bars with her. Ain't going to happen. Listen, I want to tell her right now. Listen, you're not going to get anything with that heart. You're not going to get anything. I just told her. Listen, I see the uncertainty in you. And until you're willing to surrender your whole life to Jesus, you're not going to get what the Bible talks about. So let's get this straight, because I don't want you to come up here thinking that, you know, you tried it out and it didn't work. You know, I want you to understand you got it. There's a state of the heart. And I look at people who are sitting in church who've gone just so far with Jesus, and they're not willing to go all the way. And we're going to have to get passionate about what he told you. He told you to go cast out devils and raise the dead, so not do it. And stop playing around. And when, if you're not going to obey God, why should you expect anymore? And then you have all these people, you have all these things. Well, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I'm doing that. Look, get to work. It's fun. It's no sacrifice. You're going to have to imagine big. You're going to have to feel different about yourself. You know what I want you to feel about yourself? Get you ready? I want you to feel like you're Jesus. I want you to imagine that Christ is in you, and that you walk even as he walks, that you led by the Spirit, walk in the Spirit and move in the Spirit, that you put on the Lord Jesus Christ, that you have the mind of the Spirit, the mind of Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That as he is in this world, so are you. That kind of, you know, you're holy even as he's holy. Wow. You know what I like to do is I like to get at it, man, start preaching a message on the holiness of God and build it up for what it really is, and then tell everybody, well, you're just as holy if you receive the gift. Because he made it a gift. It's a gift of holiness, a gift of righteousness. Do you know how many people sit in a church and never heard first time that they received a gift of holiness, that they received a gift of righteousness? They've not even heard it. It's not even been told to them. They know nothing about the divine nature. They know nothing about that they were infused with the life of Christ, that the life of Christ Jesus was imparted to them. They get to live a heavenly life, a glorious life, an abundant life. Give me a break. Everybody just get up and go start preaching somewhere. But you're going to have to get baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. It's got to become a living reality in your life. Otherwise, you're going to get up there and you're going to be a firecracker that don't go off. You're going to tell everybody about how the fuse, you're getting ready, the fuse is getting ready to be light lit, and all you're going to do is go smoke. It'll be nothing. And people are going to go home, at best go home and say, wow, that was an amazing message. Oh, wow, it was amazing. Oh, wow. It was very logical and sensible. That was really good. Now turn on TV. Give me something to eat. And we're going to go back next week, and hopefully it's going to be just as exciting. And if it's not, we're going to move to another church where they can give us an exciting message and a thrilling message. So we can go back home, turn on TV, and get ourselves something to eat. You hear what I'm saying to you? Okay, so you have to change. I'm telling you, everything around you is going to change. I'm telling you, this whole world's going to change. I'm telling you right now, Christ Jesus is going to come in the very near future, and everything's going to change, and there'll be one shred of demonic power left on the face of the earth. Everything is going to be subject to him, praise God. And probably before that, things are going to radically change, because you're not going to be in, we're not going to see you no more. You're going to be in the grave somewhere, and you're going to be out there in the unseen realm somewhere. And that's going to be a really big change. And we want it to be an excellent change. And somebody tried to tell me about whether it was going to be the catching away in the before the tribulation or in the tribulation or out of the tribulation. I said, listen, man, I just want you to make heaven, okay? Why don't you just forget about that for a minute? Why don't we talk about whether or not Christ Jesus has been allowed to be infused into your life and you living for him? Let's talk about that. Hallelujah. Listen to this. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you something so beautiful, so wonderful, that you would think everybody would be excited about. And look. And in a right mind, in a right attitude, where we really believe that these things are true, we would be excited about it. I just want to run four verses of Scripture by you real quick, okay? I want to run four verses of Scripture by you really quick. I want to run 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 12 by you, and I want to run Ephesians chapter 3, 19 by you, and I want to run 1 John 4, 16 by you. And then we'll run Jude 1:20-21 by you. And I want to just see what on earth is our problem. When God has made it so easy for us to have all the fullness of his glory be made manifest right here, made manifest in your home. I went to a church and began to preach on a little bit on what kind of home you can have. And you know, I got a witness to what kind of home you can have. I mean, I got a wonderful wife full of the Holy Ghost and four kids full of the Holy Ghost that have married spouses full of the Holy Ghost. I mean, come on. And those people sat there with their jaws, I mean, on the floor. Captivated by the glory like a sponge, dry sponge soaking up water. And I'm going, my goodness. There is a hunger for the word. There are people that are desperate about not sitting there saying, well, I got another idea. I thought you were going to seek God for your ideas. I thought you were going to ask God, the Holy Ghost, to lead you and show you how to do these things. Huh? And then people are so arrogant and full of pride. Well, yeah, but I want him to come tell me personally, not through you. Because I don't believe in apostles and prophets. I don't believe God put apostles in the church. Not by practice, not by theory, by practice. If you believe God put apostles and prophets in the church and teachers in the church, guess where you go find your information from? You hear me? If you believe God put apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers in the church for your perfection, guess where you go get maturity from? Guess where you go get help from? Guess where you'd go submit yourself to get insight from? I mean, I have people tell me all the time about things people said that they're going to do around here. And I go, really? Somebody said, well, we're going to do a Christmas program. Really? Nobody asked me. Nobody even told me. People run a church like that, have a church, and have a mentality like that. They tell you? I mean, who did they tell? And they got this thing and that thing. And those are the least of the matters. People do this all over the place. It's just the way church runs. And then they wonder why it is that they can't move in the things of God. Why they can't have the things of God. They're just doing their own thing, man. They don't have any respect. You know, the Lord said to me, he said to me about 2 weeks ago, he said, people trample all over the anointing and then wonder why I don't move. They trample all over the anointing. They trample all over the things of the Spirit and then wonder why my glory is made manifest in their life. I said, Lord, you're going to have to tell them, because I tried. And nobody listening to me. And everybody else I know that is an apostle and a prophet, they're not listening to them either. So, Papa, you're going to have to do something here. And you know what I hear Father say? He said, I'm going to raise them up. I'll raise them up out of the world. I'll raise them up. I'll raise them up of children who do not even know, whose heart, who don't even know, not made any choices. And I'm going to tell you right now, I wouldn't sit there and think that I was going to be left out. I had determined long ago that I'll be at ground zero anytime God moves. And I position myself to do so. I don't only imagine it and determine it. I position myself to be so and to do so. I'm not just a hope so. Well, I'm just going to be hanging out. And if it just so happens to work out. I was telling this preacher one time. I said, when the move of God takes place, I'll be at ground zero. And he said to me, oh, you can't determine that. I said, oh, yes, I can. About 6 years later, I was standing up on a platform here in San Diego with about 2,000 people in the meeting and some of the primary leaders of revival in 1994 and 95, and he came into the meeting and I waved at him and smiled real big because I was right at ground zero at the outpouring of what God did in the 90s, right in the very midst of it. And all the revival leaders, dear close friends, because Papa just put me right in the midst of it. Why? Because I determined. That's what I want. That's all I want. I don't care about nothing else. I don't care about money. I don't care about food. I don't care about a pillow. I don't care about a house. I don't care about things. I don't care about a church. I don't care. I care about you and your glory and your power and your splendor. Yeah. I can ride a bike. I don't even need a bike. My legs work great. All I want is you. But when you seek him, he gives you everything too. But when you seek everything, you get a little bit of him, maybe. At least you get a little religion. Huh? Is that what people want? When all the time the house of God lies waste? When all the time that which is supposed to be a light to the world, a city set up on a hill, in a dark place, I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me. In a dark place, when there's a light on and there's only one light, everybody's coming. Everything's coming. Every living thing's coming to that light. You would be. There was nothing but darkness in San Diego? Huh? There was no fires to be had. There was no lights to be had. And there was a light setting upon a hill. You'd start moving in that direction. Oh, yeah, you would. And that's what Papa's determined us to be, but he's determined in a very specific way. I was ministering this to a preacher just the other day in Birmingham, Alabama. He has a large church, and I was just talking to him about what Father's purpose the church to be and when will we cooperate. And I watched this man of God just begin to process this thing and ultimately decide, that's what I want. And but there's a big price to pay for him. And there's really a big price for everybody to pay. There's a big price for you to pay. And so Luke chapter 16, we discover if you're unfaithful in a little, you're going to be unfaithful in a lot. If you're faithful in a little, you're going to be faithful in a lot. Listen, in other words, whether you got little or whether you got a lot, there's a price to pay that's really almost like too big. You can't imagine your way out of it. You can't see your way out of it. You can't see a different situation. You can't imagine jumping off of the sad go-around. Not the merry-go-round, the sad go-around. You can't imagine just bailing off into the arms of Jesus, just jumping off and going to heaven. Well, guess what? That could happen without your will tonight. Could happen. You could breathe out your last breath. I'm so desperate about fulfilling everything that God's purpose for my life, I'm not dying because he needs people on the planet like me. I'm so desperate to see not something of my own making or of my own choosing or of my own purposes or from my own successes or whatever. I'm interested in seeing that which God described his church to be come into manifestation where everybody begins to make Jesus the ruler, the sovereign, glorious King of Kings, and let the Holy Ghost begin to flow through them and take over them where they begin to speak out of tongues and the interpretation of that tongue comes just with that tongue as well. And that's how you talk on a normal basis because that's how God talks through us. Just think about that. No, you know, I wasn't too long ago. You listen to me, I'll tell you. Not too long ago, Papa said, I'm not even interested in all the singing and the preaching. I'm not even interested in it. I said that the other day and the place went silent. He said, God, the Holy Ghost told me he wasn't interested in the singing and the preaching. Well, what are we going to do? What on earth is he saying? That is just contrary to the Bible. He's interested in us flowing in the Holy Ghost that produces the singing and produces the preaching. We've got it all the way up. We shut the Holy Ghost out of it because we got the program coming down. We've already decided what we're going to do. The calendar is full. Praise God. There's no light. There's no fruit. It's a dry and barren tree that Jesus is going to curse. You listen to me. You don't believe that, but it's true. There was a time appointed, and he looked, and it didn't. And that time appointed, there was no fruit brought forth when there was plenty of time for the fruit to have been born. And he said, "I'm going to take the kingdom. I'm going to give it to a nation to bring forth the fruits thereof." Now, if he comes to that nation, which is the church, is he going to have diverse weights and measures? Is he going to have a different kind of a judgment about it? Is he saying, "Father, give me time with it. Be patient. Let me till around it. Let me work with the soil. Let me put more fertilizer on it." Father needs to come to us, Annalyn, and find people that are desperate that say, "I know who God is. You cannot tell me. I'm tied to him and he's tied to me. I'm under a direct command. I'm not sitting here wondering whether or not he's going to respond to me. He's commanded me to do these great signs and wonders. He's commanded me to flow in his anointing. I'm going to get out of the doubt. I'm going to get out of the questions. I'm going to get out of the realms of the uncertainty. I'm going to start moving in the boldness of that which God dictates and quit acting like I'm trying to get to another level. What if I don't get to that level? What if? You don't make heaven. Come on, man. Huh? Look at the passion in Paul. He walks in the fullness of the glory of Christ Jesus. So he says that Christ Jesus manifested in his mortal flesh. He says he fully preached the gospel with signs and wonders and the demonstration of the power. And yet, having done all of that, having all those miracles, he says, "That I might win Christ. Oh, that I might know him in the fellowship of his sufferings, that I might be made conformable unto his death. That I might, by any means possible, attain the resurrection of the dead." Huh? The passion, the ongoing. This is what happens, just what happens to you when you get over here in the glory. Huh? You, that's that much more stirred. You're that much more zealous. You're that much more bold. I'm not looking for anything else. Listen, I have things and plans that I'm doing that I believe are God plans. Only God can fulfill them, and I let him fulfill them, and I don't worry one little bit about it. What does it take to become tender towards God and soften towards God and obedient towards God, where you begin to participate with the kind of church that he created rather than the one that you want to create? Or I want to create, or anyone else wants to create. Why don't we want the church that has the manifestation of the Spirit given to everybody? Why don't we want to have a church that's got this kind of authority and glory, this mouthpiece from heaven, both the apostle with the authority to speak out God's word, and the seer to see God's word and understand where we were at, and the teacher to declare God's word, all by the power of the Holy Ghost? You know. See, you're just going to have to be passionate about it. And to be passionate about it, you say the wait is over. I step into it. I believe what God says. I'm under his dictate. I'm not waiting for him now to somehow answer some faithless prayer where I'm asking him to do what he's already said he's done. What's up with that? Think about it. Think about it. I pray in Jesus' name, you are just so arrested by God's word, you can't go be the slave to the system and do your same old thing tomorrow and live on your same little patterns of life. When all the time, that glory that Father purchased for us in Christ Jesus lays waste. Its mantle's fallen. It's like Elijah having cast his mantle to the ground. And Elisha just walks by and says, "Well, you know, man, I can't believe he left. I served him and I was supposed to get an anointing and he's gone out of here. Now I'm just going to go home, try to regroup. Even though I sold my oxen, maybe I can buy one or two, buy myself a heifer and get myself a bull. And after a while, we'll have it back." There's mantles laying all over the place. There's mantles laying all over. The church lays waste. Where is the body of Christ functioning, baptized in one spirit, functioning as one man under the authority of the Holy Ghost, with all those exploits, with all those glorious realms, and the demonstration of the Holy Spirit being made manifest? Where is these things? For Father desires them. He's in pains over it. All you and I got to do is imagine that we're a part of it, and all of a sudden begin to function in obedience to what God has said, and start doing, walking with the Holy Ghost, and we're immediately there. We're just there. We're there right then, just by the moment of agreement, and then all the rest of it that I just described will be there. It's not like it's prerequisites, really, because it just happens at the moment of choice. Then you're not imagining what the pastor did wrong, because that's stinking demonic. The critical thing, the strife thing, the division thing, the accusers, the accusing things. That's what Satan's constantly doing, is accusing. And who's he accusing more than anyone else? Somebody with an anointing to see a change come. That are someone with the anointing declaring the word of God that can go in as viable seed into hearts prepared of God that then by the natural consequence bears fruit. So that's why I want to read these verses of scripture to you. I'm a little tired tonight. But I got a passion on the inside of me that's bigger than any tired thing, any tired effect could ever have. I got a desire bigger than anything. I believe in God. And I believe in an eternal realm. And I believe that Christ Jesus poured out all the glory of heaven upon anyone who would receive. And I believe that in a very short time, I'm going to give an account for my response to all that he's done. I believe that God raised me up to bring change to the church. And I'm going to, with all that is within me, go after it. And if I can, at the same time, raise up missionaries for the mission field, raise up sustainable food sources for orphanages, fine. But there ain't nothing in my way of the objective. And that's the church. That's the glorious church. Jesus died for the church. Jesus gave his life for the church. That's how much he loves the church. I'm following my master. And I'm just crying. I'm crying out by the Spirit of the Lord, believing that there's going to be other people who will follow Jesus as well and lay their life down for the church. He so loved the church that he gave himself for it, that it might be glorious, spotless, and beautiful, arrayed in glorious garments and the fullness of all that the Father himself possesses. Just because I've been screaming this out for 34 years, don't make it old. And the only people that got a problem are those who have heard it for 34 years and haven't done it. That's it. And that problem can be remedied. It can be remedied tonight. The yoke can be broken. The violations against the Spirit can be remedied by the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And by a changed heart, because I'm telling you right now, you're going to deal with it now, or you're going to deal with it at the judgment seat. And I wouldn't go for that. It ain't going to work out. You better let the floodlight of heaven shine upon your soul and start causing an evaluation of what you're doing with your life and with your time, where your desires are, what you really feel about Jesus, what you really feel about God, what you really feel about the Holy Ghost, what you really feel about the commission that he's given to us and the responsibility that is resting now upon our shoulders, how you feel about the responsibility that we right now have for souls by the multiplied millions, forgive me, going into hell, how you and I feel about the social system and the structure of the United States of America as it becomes more grossly wicked because the hinder of iniquity aren't doing their job, because a glorious church isn't shining the way it's supposed to shine. Yeah, we need to have a pyramid. Yeah, you need to fast and pray. Yeah, but you need to move as soon as you do. I'll tell you right now, fasting and praying helps the waistline. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? It also helps you in a whole lot of other ways. I've been looking at some people, you know, because I can tell when people are fasting. I've been fasting a long time. Anybody can. But some people may not be as discerning. They think, wow, this person's losing weight. No, they're fasting. You can tell. I see so many wonderful men of God fasting. It's beautiful. Wow. You know why? Papa's stirring it. He's stirring it. He said, okay, look, I'm going to shift this thing. I'm going to do something sovereignly. See, I've been describing to you, if you're cultivating the fruit that the husbandman, that the father is cultivating, then when he comes and his sovereign moves, as Hosea describes them, in Hosea chapter 6, verse 3, the scripture says, then we shall know. We will know those who passionately pursue the Lord. King James translated it, follow on another Lord. Passionately pursue the Lord. I'm giving you a direct translation from the Hebrew language. And he shall come unto us. He shall come to us as the early and the latter rain. That's the sovereign movings of God. There's something that's getting ready to happen. And there are going to be people who are like, they just sit with total bent. I've suffered the loss of everything. I count it all but none that I'm for the excellency of the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Father, you know I'm going to be at ground zero. Father, I believe everything you said. And I know that I don't have to talk you into it. You've been trying to talk me into it. That you've made it available. You poured out your spirit upon all flesh. Anybody who wants it. It's not you not responding to me. It's me not responding to you. I mean, we get straight, right? We let the floodlight of heaven shine upon our soul. We get this thing straightened out. We get ourselves right with God. We get ourselves out of doubt, out of demonic doubt and unbelief, stubborn, rebellious doubt, huh? And unwillingness. And we step up and we say, this is what God says, let's go. This is what God said to do, let's do it now, huh? And you might have to wrestle yourself around a few dead bodies and get a little bit of, you know, embalming fluid on you, but go for the third one because it's probably coming up. Huh? You might have to drag a few people out of the wheelchairs and they get this skin up their knees and then, you know, they get a little bit hurt and somebody screams and hollers at you for being such a wild person. But by the fourth or fifth one, I'm going to tell you right now, they'll start walking and you'll start tallying for the kingdom of God. You'll start getting yourself badges of honor from the Father. Somebody's willing to believe. Somebody's willing to stand up with radical boldness, with great imaginations concerning the word that I had declared, and see themselves doing it and allow me to be God. We tell them, oh, you're not feeling good? Well, you know, if I pray for you, you might get healed. Do you mind if I touch you? Forget about it. Ain't nothing going to happen. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. I know because I do it. I know how it works. I know how it works. And right now, you know, I don't see 100% of the people healed, and I'm upset with my response to God. Because God wants 100% of the people healed, and so I press in. You know how I press in? I keep running harder. I keep hitting it harder. I keep shouting harder. I keep crying out to God, Father, Ann and I can run harder. Lord, I don't care what it takes. I don't care what we have to do. Father, just we'll do it. There was a time where Father said, well, then hit the streets. So he'd tell me that. And he'd tell me, hit the streets then. And I'd hit the streets. Now he tells me to do other things. Now he's telling me hit the churches. The Lord started telling me hit the churches 6 months ago. And I said, okay, Father, I'm willing to do whatever. And now the door is flying open. And everywhere we go, here's what's happening. Just like it was overseas in third world countries, it's the way it's happening in the United States of America, and it's the way it's going to continue to happen, and everywhere we go, it's just shocking, shocking. And I'm just blessed. I love getting picked up by someone in a car who feels that they need to pull over because they're about to faint in the presence of God, and they haven't got the capacity. They're sober-minded, they don't have the capacity to drive. And I'm tired, and I didn't say nothing. I just got in the car and said, hi. Because I've been traveling all day. Because we carry an anointing. I know what I carry. I know what. And you're going to have to understand what you carry. You're going to have to get a hold of what you carry or don't carry. And you don't carry nothing in doubt and unbelief. But if you believe God, you'll start carrying a glorious, sizable anointing that'll slay any giant, that will knock out any disease, that will manifest the life of Jesus Christ. And it'll be so exciting to you that you don't want any other kind of life. You'll retire from all other interests.
you retire from all other interest. You know, we have, God's blessed us with beautiful things. In comparison to the glory, they're all ugly to me. They're all dirt, burned up ugly to me. Huh? They are. Everything in his presence, everything compared to his presence is nothing. It's meaningless, isn't it? It's ash. It's dust. It's worthless. The problem is people just haven't come in the presence. They haven't seen the glory. So they look at this stuff and they're just, ooh, this is so beautiful. They're idolizing. Oh, it's so precious. Oh, I can't live without it. Oh, I got to have it. Oh, it's so beautiful. So emotionally attached to it. Encounter Jesus. It'll become dirt to you, man. It'll become worthless and meaningless to you. You hear me now? Father's looking for some people. He's looking for some. There's got to be some people who are going to stand up and believe him. Quit dilly-dallying around, because I'm going to tell you right now. You see Jesus, you get filled with Jesus, you begin to walk in the life of Jesus, and your addictions and your shortcomings and your sins and your problems are going to be there. Aren't going to be a problem anymore. Hallelujah. Jesus is coming, purify yourself. Let me say that again. Jesus is coming, purify yourself. Everyone who has this hope purifies himself even as he's pure. Hallelujah. And that's in the context of, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we should be, but we know that when we see him, we should be like him, for we will see him as he is. Everyone who has this hope purifies himself even as he's pure. Everyone who has this hope, and I can say it this way too, is holy even as he is holy. Walks even as he walks. Is even as he is. Lives even as he lives. See, I put on the Lord Jesus Christ. I had a man of God sit me down the other day and he said, look, something happened to you. Somewhere, somehow, you received the renewed mind that I don't see in anybody else. What happened? I said, I just gave myself to thinking God's thoughts by living by God's word. And I didn't stop. And I'm not going to stop. And it ain't something, you're born again just like I was born again. I just gave myself to this word. I gave myself to memorizing the word. More than that, I gave myself to living the word. Because I know a lot of people that memorize the word, they never live it. I gave myself to doing it. I was excited about doing it. I still get chill bumps reading the miracles of Jesus. My hair still stands up on the back of my head because it's so real to me. Somebody said, well, God, the Holy Ghost made it real to you. Well, God, the Holy Ghost make it real to you too. Unless God might just so happen to be a respecter of persons and he just saved me and leaving you out, which is nonsense. It just has to do with the fact that I'm all in on this. I'm just excited about this. I want this. It fills my prayer. It's more important to me than my necessary food. I've been so lovesick for Jesus, I didn't want to drink water. I want nothing. I want him. You ever been that lovesick? If you've never been that lovesick, God's got that lovesick for you, but you're going to have to give yourself over to believing, being faithful with what he's already given you and believing what he's already said. You're going to have to begin to deal with the strongholds and the wild imagination, the demonic power that has come against you, and you've never risen up in the God power that has been given to you and cast it down. You're going to have to get into the fight. You're going to have to get into battle. You're going to have to quit playing, you know, like you somehow you're supposed to be rock-a-bye baby in the crib. Huh? It's about time for you to stand up. Recognize, wait a minute. Baby, time's over. We engage now. You fight for everything. As people fight. I see people fight for their mortgage, and they fight for their position. They fight for what they want. Yeah, you fight for what you want, right? When you get into battle. Start throwing down. When you're going to make up your mind that God's word is right and God is God and Jesus Christ is Lord, then you'll fight. You'll be angry against every thought that would come against your mind to try to violate this faith realm, to try to violate this relationship realm, to try to violate this boldness realm, to try to violate this confidence realm. You'll get fighting mad. You'll start screaming and hollering in your car. Your mouth will be as wide as your whole face, and people will be going by and saying that person has lost their mind. You'll be lifting up your voice because there'll be a passion. There'll be a cry from the heart instead of the head. It won't be prayer meeting as usual. It'll be the real thing. You call unto me and I'll answer you. Because it's coming from deep within. You got to have this. Make believe, posing, pretending, just having something ain't going to do no more. I ain't going to do no more. Not when heaven is my home. Not when my name is written in the Lamb's book of life. Not when God has given me this kind of opportunity. Not when Jesus has paid this kind of price. Not when the Holy Ghost has personally come to mentor me, come to live with me. He's in me. Not when you begin to believe God is in you. I used to believe that if I could just teach people God is in you, that they would stand up with great boldness. All they did was sit down with some kind of, I don't know what. You believe God's in you, you're going to stand up and you're going to be so bold to do that which he commanded us to do. It should remove all doubt and all separation and all sense of inadequacy and inability. Satan constantly twisting the word. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to get an anointing while I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill his influence in every meeting that we go to. I'm going to kill his influence. Why? Because I'm more fighting mad than I've ever been. I'm so sick and tired of Satan twisting the words. I'm so sick and tired of the things that would intercept the word and try to cast down the word. I'm. Come on, men. There's going to be a people. There'll be a people. Paul's going to have people in the herd. He's got me. He's got Ann. I heard maybe one other me. That was it. I like one me's, two me's, three me's. Because see, but understand, it's a spiritual condition. See, all that is a revelation of a spiritual condition. It's everywhere. It's not just here. It's an atmosphere oppression to where people can't just reach out and grab a hold of it. They're like shut down. They're under a gag order. You got to break out of that. You're going to break out of it by engaging the word. You're going to break out of it by engaging, by binding yourself to the word, binding yourself to the spirit. And I only believe about myself what God said. People got all these ideas. All I believe is what God said. Therefore, that's why I can live it. That's why my mouth is open. That's why if I'm in somebody else's meeting and they say something like that, I'm going, that's me. I met David Hogan last night. David Hogan said, well, I'm God's favorite son. I said, I'm God's favorite son. He said, you're right. Because it is. It's there. If that's the reality and you're not intimidated and that's some kind of oppression and fear, I'm living out the dream. We invited you. Come live the dream. Come live the dream. Come live the dream. Get out of whatever the crisis you're in. Come live the dream. Be broken free from whatever prison you live in. Come live the dream. Be broken free from the oppression. Come fly in the realms of divine power and glory. God has all these things for you. People think that they can search around and it's going to be found by some location. Well, if I go over here, it's going to work. And this is what happens. And they go over there and it's all fluttery butterfly for a little while. And then, oh no, they got to go over here. Maybe it's going to happen over here. And, oh, it's all sweet and butterfly for a while. And then, oh, it's not happening. Then they go over here and they spend their whole life chasing something that has nothing to do with reality. That's not how God begins to work within our life. That's not how the wellspring springs and the rivers flow. God describes it very perfectly, how the wellsprings spring and the river flows. We begin to believe he's God, that Jesus Christ is King of kings and Lord of lords, and that we've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, that he's in us and with us, that we the walking, living personal representation of Jesus Christ, for Christ is in us. Hallelujah. And we dwell in him. Hallelujah. Just like the Father dwells in him. Hallelujah. He dwells in us. Josh said, just like the Father dwells in him, he dwells in me. And that gives me such boldness and confidence to do the things that God has commissioned me to do. I don't have no intimidation. There ain't no baby, nothing in this place in my life. There ain't no backing down, fear at all. No soft pedaling this thing. And we run out of adjectives to describe the mess. People all bound up with their self and their uselessness and the prisoner to their own identity and person. And God wants us to take the identity of Jesus. That's what the new birth is about. That's what it means to be born again, to become a new man, to receive the divine nature. That's what this is all about. It's not about for us to sit around and say, my doctrine's bigger than your doctrine, or my doctrine's better than yours. It's about a living reality. Anybody who's got a hold of the living reality of God in them and begins to move out with that kind of confidence and boldness, they got the right doctrine. They got the one that works. All the rest of them are questionable. You know, ma'am, the words might be coming out of your mouth right, but you understand it wrong because it doesn't work for you. You hear me? Words might be coming out of your mouth right. It might be orthodoxy. But what's more important than orthodoxy is orthopraxy. Jesus said the doer. See, faith is nothing but the outworking of the word in our life. That's all it is. Faith is, that's why James says, show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works, because faith is nothing more than the outworking of God's word in our life, because we begin to move. I mean, Reinhard Bonnke said it right. There's one thing God can't do, get you up out of the off your couch. You're going to have to start obeying God and moving out. And this is about day in and day out, because this is where it becomes solidified. I want you to look at the scripture differently. I want you to look at it. I want you to look at it in both Romans chapter 12, verse 2, and Ephesians 4, 23. I want you to look at it different, because they're the same thing, same phrase. I want you to start thinking differently, because you're stuck in the renewal of the mind. You're thinking about an event. He's asking me about an event. Obviously, an event has happened to you because you're different. You think different. I've watched you over and again, and you're always, you don't even have your own opinion. You always bring it back to the Word. It's always about the Word of God. I see you living this and speaking it and breathing it, and then I see you practice it, and I see the miracles at work, and I see the fire of God fall. Okay? What happened? It's not an event. It's not an event. It's a life. It's a life. It's a consecration. Take the cords and bind the sacrifice to the horns of the altar. That happened to me. I'm his purchased possession. Hallelujah. Woo! I'm no longer alive. I died with Jesus Christ. I raised up again with him. I was buried with him. I've been raised up together with him. I'm alive in him. I'm living the glorious life. I'm living the dream life. I'm living the heavenly life. I'm living the blessed life. I don't need your 401, 510K, whatever other retirement plans. I don't need your health programs. I don't need your job enterprise or your you know, career path maintenance. I'm a stranger and a sojourner. I'm seeking a kingdom whose builder and maker is God. And I'm not taking concern about what I'm going to eat. And I'm not concerned about what I'm going to wear. I'm seeking first the kingdom. I want the power of the kingdom of God to be revealed in my life. Jesus said, if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then somebody done sought the kingdom. Somebody's done seeking the kingdom. Somebody's grabbed a hold of the kingdom. Somebody's got kingdom life. I'm telling you, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but the kingdom of God is righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. And somebody starts living out righteousness and living out joy and living out peace. The world says, well, somebody's got the kingdom. What happened to you? What event took place that renewed your mind? I tell you, I think different. I'm tempted with sin just like everybody else. I just belong to him, and I don't have a will, and I'm not going to do it. I got enough wisdom to recognize that all it's going to do is create death and destruction anyways. You're not going to find me in the lust of the flesh or the lust of the eye and the pride of life. Because if I happen to trip up in it, I'm going to be out of it in 2 seconds. Hallelujah. Why? Because I'm being led by the Holy Ghost. I'm walking in the Spirit of truth. I got the light of heaven shining upon my soul. I got the one who convinces and convicts us of sin. He's right there on me, in me, telling me. And I'm loving him every moment of it. Teaching me. Come on. Hallelujah. Woo-hoo! Somebody said, several people said, I didn't even know anybody preached like that. My goodness gracious, that's a sad situation. Everybody ought to be preaching like this. Should be the least to preaching. Come on. Yeah, the voice, I mean, I'm passionate about saying nothing except what the Word of God said. So one preacher stood up and said, my goodness, you done thrown out 400 verses of scripture. And you unhappy about not just speaking the word only. Yeah, I am. Because Jesus is going to come confirm his word. Yeah, I am. Because as long as we're going to do it our own way, we're going to always find a ceiling. There's always going to just be just so much of an anointing. All of a sudden, somebody gets a little bit more anointed. Somebody else got a little bit of edge. And now we got a deliverer that's been raised up on Zion, Mount Zion. Well, God's about to raise up some deliverers on Mount Zion. You watch what happens. Hallelujah. Obadiah 121 is about to shine. I'm telling you right now, that's not millennial time only. I'm telling you, that's these times right now. There's a lot of things that look like the millennial only. I'm telling you, it belongs to the church. Just like he shall pour out a spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. You shall dream dreams. Hallelujah. And you shall have visions. I'm not going to live without them. I'm not going to live without him. I'm stepping into a whole nother realm of seeing the open vision. I'm asking God to teach me because I don't even know what it is. I'll see it literal, living, breathing faces, people looking at me with certain things going on in their life. I don't even know what it is yet. I'm being trained. I'm going to another place and dimension of that which God's glory is there, available to give everybody. But you got to be willing to participate and grow and mature. People, you got to let your spirit become something more than just a newborn babe. You're going to have to start desiring the sincere miracle of the word, the sincere nourishment of the word, so you can grow thereby. And you're going to have to start exercising so that you have sinew and strength and muscle upon yourself, so that you can start moving with what God has to do, so that you can get big in these things. The more you participate with love, the more love will flow through you. The more you participate with healing, the more you participate with tongues. A dear friend of mine who God used to shake the nations of the earth in the 90s. God took his name and threw it throughout the earth. What he did was he found everybody, especially those who had great anointings in their life. He recorded them speaking in tongues and tongues and interpretations of tongues. And he had about a 2-3 hour series of it, and he constantly listened to it. I do something similar to that. I'm right there. Anything I can find where somebody has touched around, I don't care who they are. I don't have a bad opinion about anybody who's got an anointing from the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I'm in it. I'm just hovering over top of it. I'm imagining something greater. I'm imagining all that. I get so excited about anybody moving in the gifts of the Spirit. I was watching A.A. Allen the other night, that long series that he has of one miracle after another miracle after another miracle. And then he's got this woman up there, and he said, now, and he's praying because she's deaf in one ear. And he said, now you said you believed. You said you had faith in Jesus Christ. Don't you disappoint God tonight. Woo! I tell you right now, I grab a hold of that stuff. I love that stuff. I feed on that, man. That's life. That's manna. That's those expressions of the Holy Ghost coming from those who have been raised up that are already gone dead. I can still grab hold of what they said. I can still grab a hold of what Jack Cole said. I can still grab a hold of what Oral Roberts said. I can still grab a hold of what Catherine Coleman said. I can still grab a hold of some of the things that Mariah Woodworth Edwards said. Some of the things that John F. that John G. Lake did and said, some of the things F.F. Bosworth said, Christ the Healer. I can still grab a hold of some of the things that T.L. Osborne said and did. I can lay hold on all this stuff, and I still want more. That ain't enough for me. Well, you think you can have it without getting in all of that? Being hungry for those same things? You think you can just live offline going after something that's purely natural, that all it does is develop the human, that develops the human mind and human ability? And leave the things of the Spirit completely undone and grow in these things. Nonsense. You're not going to do it. Ain't going to happen. Anybody stands up here, they preach the word, they got to demonstrate it. And if you can't demonstrate the word, it's simply because you don't believe. That's all. It's because you're living under fear. Huh? Hello. Come on now. Get out of the fear. Somebody said, how? Just do what God said to do. You don't think that the apostles were scared to death when the Lord said, now you go do the works, I'm sending you out 2 by 2, go do the works? They're like still going, what manner of man is he? What works do you want us to do? I want you to raise the dead. What? You want us to what? Yeah, I want you to cast out devils, also open up the eyes of the blind. I want you to tell the mute to speak and the deaf to hear. Are you coming with us? No, you're going on your own. I would have hate to be paired up with Thomas. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine how difficult that would have been? Jesus. You ready for this? I'm going to give you something. I'm going to give you something that you're going to have to be willing to give yourself to. And it's going to start right in your home. It's going to start in your relationships. It's going to start. And you may discover that you do not have the strength. And all that's going to do is disclose to you how you've lived by your own spirit, how you've lived doing your own will rather than living by the Holy Ghost and doing the will of the Father. Now, here's the good news. You can begin to get desperate and say, Holy Ghost, I am so sorry. I'm so sorry. From this day forward, I'm going to live by you. I recognize you've given me the ability. You've given me the power. You've given me everything that I need. And I've just been willing to do it my own way, headlong, doing whatever it is I think, what somebody told me it's supposed to look like, rather than what you described in detail it's supposed to look like. So let's just turn with me quickly to 1 Thessalonians. I'm sure some of you have been camped out there for a while, right? 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. Listen to this. That's got to get 11. That just hits you. It's like it almost blinds me when I look at it. I'm telling you, it has an effect on every part of my being. Somebody said, how is that? Because I'm over in a place called the Holy Ghost. My emotions, my feelings, my body is under the influence of someone named the Holy Spirit. If I was sitting around feeling bad about myself, dreaming of something more in this earth, I wouldn't feel nothing either. Are you listening to me? I want you to get this. I'm laying it out there. I'm going to lay it out in the strongest words, filled with the most love that I possibly can. That you will just say, enough is enough. I'm going to believe in God from now on. I'm going to let God be God. He's God. I'm going to let Jesus Christ be Lord. And I'm going to believe the Holy Ghost is with me and in me. And I'm going to start obeying God. I'm going to start learning what it means to flow in the Holy Ghost 24/7. Hallelujah. And the beautiful thing is, the Father's going to go, imagine that. I believe that's an underplay of what he would be doing. I believe he would be dancing and jumping and leaping. I believe the Zephaniah 3 thing would be coming alive where he's singing a song over you and moving in the round dance. Say, woohoo! Just believes. Put your name there. I got somebody who's going to start moving in that which I paid such a costly price. You take your son, you bind your son, and you take him, you put him on an altar and throw your knife into his throat. Let's see you do it. Papa did it. And we need to feel it. And we need to be touched by it. And we're going to have to stop embarrassing the cross and embrace it. Hello. Wrong E word. Doubt and unbelief. It won't be long, dear people. Everything's going to change. You get the option to change first. You can change with or without your will. But one way or the other, you're changing. Everything about you is going to change. Your circumstances, your situation, where you live, where you lay down, what you do, it's all going to change. If it's nothing more than changing by death, it's going to change radically. And I don't want anybody waking up in hell. It's a terrible bed to lay down in. And I'm concerned that many people that believe they're going to heaven aren't going to hell. They've never quit sinning. They've never quit rebelling. They've never repented over things that they have literally trampled the anointing in. They violated things right, left, and center and found an excuse for it. Because Satan will provide you excellent excuses for why you trampled the anointing and violated the sacred things. I'll provide you with an arsenal of absolute logical conclusions of why you were right. What you got to do is get enough wisdom to recognize there's no justification ever for it. And all you can do is repent. And maybe you can't remember all the sins you've done. Maybe you can't remember all the offenses that you've done. Maybe you can't remember all the violations that was against God himself. The beautiful thing tonight is you can throw yourself upon the altar of his mercy and of his grace and say, Lord, forgive me. Lord, I know I've done it wrong. I've thought it wrong. I've imagined it wrong. I've believed it wrong. I've walked it wrong. My moaning and my complaining and my murmuring and my attitudes are only just a clear indication to myself right now of how I've done it. Lord Jesus, take your blood. I mean, you know, it would be almost like me taking and opening up one of these Welch grape jars here and just dumping the thing on myself. You know, Lord Jesus, cleanse me with your blood. Hallelujah. Just wash me. And then as it pours over me in and outside, I begin to light up with the brightness of purity. Hallelujah. That's just God's goodness. Woo! It's his mercy that endures forever. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I feel like dancing. See, this isn't a story to me. This isn't a sermon to me. Can you tell? This is life to me. Somebody said, you don't explain it very well, but I get it. Fine, because this is no sermon to me. This is life. I feel it. This is reality to me. I'm so excited about what Jesus. There's no means by which anybody can get their sins cleansed but by the blood of Jesus Christ. And that ain't going to happen until you repent. And that ain't going to happen until you start loving one another, really. I mean, the forgiveness. God said, I'll forgive you as much as you need to be forgiven, but you're going to have to forgive. And I'm going to tell you right now, you're not going to forgive like that until you love like that. Can you hear me? And listen, husbands and wives, you get to practice on each other. You can just go ahead and tell each other your sob stories and all the reasons why you haven't, why you're dysfunctional, what happened, and who messed you up, and how you didn't have the right kind of a dad or didn't have the right kind of mom. Get through all of that stuff, you know. Maybe even get the pots and pans out on a bruise one another. I don't know what. Don't do that. But whatever, you can have time to just work through it and say, you know what, all this stuff is nonsense. All this stuff is garbage. All this stuff is meaningless. When God all this time has provided a way for all that power of demonic effect to be completely broken off of us by the blood of Jesus Christ and by the Holy Ghost. So let's get down on our knees and let's begin to pray and let's begin to ask God to show us how to live his way, live his life, walk it out in heaven, how to have the good time that he's given us to have in him. And everything just begins to take on a whole new splendor, people. And the problems, you're not going to work no problem out any more than you're going to ever be able to cleanse your own sins. Any more than you're ever going to be able to on your own deal with any demon spirit. By the blood of Jesus Christ and the Spirit of Jesus Christ and the Spirit of the Holy Ghost and hallelujah, the name that is above every name, praise God. You are blessed that you get to sit in this church. Hallelujah. And you should be so excited about the word that you go running trying to find everybody you can to get in here. Anybody that's serious to get in here. You got to hear this. You got to understand the words of life are in his house. There's apostles in his house. There's prophets in his house. There's teachers in his house. There's miracles in his house. There's healing in his house. There's that equipping power of God in his house. When you believe that, man, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to have a different attitude when you start believing God's word. When you start believing it. When God becomes God, he's really God now. Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and the Holy Ghost has come and he's in you and with you. And his word is power and living in his churches. In his churches. Alive and well. And now you're going to participate because you start participating on the very simplest ways before you're ever going to start participating on the more mature and glorious ways. You're going to start participating by getting excited about bringing people into the house of God because you believe it's the house of God. That's why you're excited about it. Now that's participation on step number one. Then it's going to go from there into the full maturation of the Son. I said it's going to go into the full maturation of the Son. I've made a goal. I've set a goal in the next 9 years. I'm going to come in the fullness and measure the maturity of the ministry of Jesus and even unto a fully matured man. That's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm doing in my life. That's how I examine my life and measure my life every day. Not every week, every day. What are you doing? Huh? You better get yourself a hold. You better get a hold of God. That's all I got to say. You better get a hold of God. Hello? I mean, you're not going to raise the dead till you can get yourself out of bed. You know what I'm saying? Huh? You with me? You're not going to be able to effectively cast out devils till you can cast out imaginations that shouldn't, thoughts shouldn't be there. You're not going to be able to show Jesus until he's real to you. He manifests himself till you can feel him. I can feel him. He's here in this place. We were here last Sunday night, and as soon as I began to move in the spirit of healing, miracles, and started praying for Allie, of course, the anointing fell upon that girl. Where's she at? Huh? Where's she at? Who's got her number? Who knows where she's at? She's crying out, help me. Oh, please help me. Oh, God, deliver me. She was serious. The Lord touched her. You know what I'm saying? People got to help. People got to be there. Souls got to become more valuable to you. I mean, what if I felt that way about you? It's about time you start being willing to be generous. God gives you things. God gave you his life for you to be generous with others. Somebody was asking me recently about the parable of Luke chapter 16, because it's a very complicated parable, very difficult parable. And really, the bottom line is the Lord says, listen, you want to get into everlasting dwellings, you better be generous with the needs of others, with what you have. It's not just money. Of course, the focus on unrighteous mammon. I mean, there's many such sayings as that. People, we're going to have to start being concerned for souls. We're going to have to start hooking up with the heart of Father. We got to still hook up with the heart of Father, how he feels about people, how much he loves them. I saw that girl, she grabbed a hold of me. I felt the love of God. You know, I've just been ministering to people the past couple of days that did messed up in so many different ways, and just overwhelmed by the love of God for them. Overwhelmed by his compassion for them. You missing out when you can't feel that. I watch too many people still hard in their emotion. You encapsulated by your human nature. You encrusted by your self-interest. God wants his fire and glory of his spirit to burn all that stuff off, so there's nothing but Jesus can be seen. Hallelujah. The compassion of Jesus, then you don't feel nothing but his. You talk about, come on. And so that's why I want to read some of this to you. It takes me a while to read. But you guys know that. You've been around me long enough. And I'm going to tell you right now. You know, listen to me. I challenge you and I provoke you, but I'm going to tell you right now. You're going to move out. You're going to move out, because I'm going to kick you in the tail end if you don't. You're going to move out. You're going to move out. I spent too much time prophesying over you. I spent too much time in this place declaring God's word. And he's promised me that it won't be in vain. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm just going to grab all of you. You're going to get it tonight, because the word of the Lord is going forward. And your heart's more receptive than ever before. And you're going to grab a hold of it. The word wouldn't be going forth like this if you weren't interested. If God the Holy Ghost wasn't talking to you. So God the Holy Ghost is definitely talking to you. And it's not too late for anybody. You can grab a hold of this right now. And everything can begin anew right now. Because his mercies are new every morning. Because his provision, his call, his giftings have not changed. He says the same thing as he's always said. He's not changed. He's waiting. He stands waiting. And we're going to respond. Okay. We're responding. We've responded. Huh? When somebody wants me to repeat after them something that's going to be in the future, I say it's now. I repeat, but I just make it now. I make it now. A now God, a now faith, a now experience, a now relationship. You know, I'm going to sit back and mealy-mouth this thing, act like be intimidated, let somebody take something from me that God has given me freely. My goodness, that's going to allow doubt in. I don't have time for doubt. Patience. Listen, dear, we've just had so much fun. It wore us out, but we had so much fun. I love casting out devils, seeing the sick healed. I love seeing pastors. I love seeing pastors energized with faith. To not back down, to step it up, to not lower the bar, to raise it. They're thinking, contemplating, look at that bar, thinking about lowering it so they can reach more people. And after we got done, they said, let's go raise that thing, man. Hallelujah. I love that. I love that. And I've been blessed by the Lord to get to practice on you for all these years.
Get honed in by the Spirit of God. Amen. But you need to get honed in. And you just do it. You just do it. You just take a hold of it like you never heard it before. And do it. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know how many of you got to see David Hogan the other night. He's a wild guy. And he, you know, there's a lot of gestures and things that I think that are unnecessary. But I'm going to tell you right now, what I was excited about is the display of boldness. And if I, you know, and if the Lord opens up for me to have a relationship, I'll let him know what I'm thinking about, what I think he needs to do. And he can do with it what he wants. But nonetheless, I love the display of the boldness. I love the display. I'm just like, you don't find me having any problem with that because we're begging people to be bold. We're just waiting for somebody to get that kind of boldness. We're just waiting for somebody to stand up and be behave themselves in Christ Jesus like that. People walking around all intimidated. Listen, people, you don't have to wonder whether or not you're the one that's going to go out into the valley and take Goliath or hide behind the rocks. You can see yourself right now. You know what I'm telling you? Huh? I know exactly where I'd have that sword. Listen, I'm telling you right now. I'd have that sword taken away from him in short order and his head off. Because I live it. I live it. You don't have to wonder. I'll be stuck. I know what I would do. I would be just like Joshua. I saw the glory. I haven't departed from the tabernacle. It wasn't a message to me. It was a reality to me. That's what stepped him over into the realms of glory. You had to decide where you at. It's hard to have any kind of complaint when you're captivated by that kind of beauty. When you got that kind of view. I got this view, man. An amazing view. And it's available for you. It's a prime spot of real estate to be able to just look and gaze at the splendor and the glory. Whew. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. I can live without sleep for this. I tell you, you know, Paul, he preached all night, then got up, and then preached all night, and then went to the next village when the sun came up. I know how he did it. This glory. Whew. This glory. We want every one of you to grab hold of it. We want every one of you to experience, love it, live in it. Because this is eternal life. This is the life of Christ. It's the life of Jesus. It's the life of the Holy Ghost. This is what it's all about. If you wouldn't like this, you wouldn't like heaven. If you don't like this, you wouldn't like God. This is it. This is the goodness. This is the abundance that Jesus was talking about. Whew. Come on. Let's turn it unto the Lord. Let's begin to move in the revival glory of heaven, where we heirs of God and co-inheritors with Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody said, well, why didn't we sing? When I feel the anointing really strong, I made the mistake in the past. If I feel the anointing really strong and I didn't preach, many times it's actually got lost in the music. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Lost in the music. That's weird, eh? Huh? Has nothing to do with whether or not the music was anointed or whether it was right praise. It has to do with what God wants to do. We just so set we do music first. And Holy Ghost, you're just going to have to like it. He ain't going to like it. I've experimented with this. And if he did it that way every time, I'd be just happy it could be. Because it's all about him. It's all about his anointing, about his word going forward, people being changed. It's not just about a sermon being preached. It's about the life-giving power of God's word going forth, people being changed so that we begin to do the works of Jesus. That's what it's about. I mean, I did enjoy Brother David Hogan mocking the Christians who sit and listen to sermons and never do it. That was enjoyable. He did a better job of it than I've ever done. I was embarrassed for everybody who didn't do signs, wonders, and miracles.
Hallelujah.
Listen, now God himself and our Father.
That'll make a shout right there, won't it?
Yes.
My God. Tell me I can't do anything. Tell me I can't. All things aren't possible. Tell me that all these things that Father described in his word aren't mine. Look at here. Look at who he is. God Almighty is my dad. Look at here. For God himself, our Father, and our Lord Jesus Christ direct our way unto you. Look at what kind of relationship Paul had. He knew what kind of mandate he was under, and I don't have any different relationship with God than he did. You can have a different one if you want, but I advise you not to. People want to make up all these ideas and all these brainy excuses, and you can see why, because they're duds and done nothing. And if they have, my goodness, it can't even be measured. In the kingdom of God, you hear, that's why they got all these brainy, crazy ideas of how somehow Paul had a unique experience with God that we don't have. Nonsense. Let me show you he did it. I'll show you he did it. By not only the word of God, but by my actions. And the word of God takes superiority too. Hallelujah. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And so, you know, I said this to the Lord about a week ago. I said, okay, Pops. Okay, Father, I got it. Amen. Okay. After I'm done teaching them all the precepts for the umpteenth time, I'm ready to start over. We'll do it again. And one day, I'm expecting an explosion. And it don't need to be many. It don't mean to be many. Because God don't need many. God sorts people out with his word. You know that? He sorts people out. He sorts people out who are really ready to go. He said, oh, all you scaredy cats, all you people that are more interested in your own houses and your own stuff, go ahead and go on back. We love you. Go be blessed. Go on back. I'd hate to be them in heaven.
Yes.
You know what I'm telling you?
Yes.
You hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
All you people don't know how to drink right, you're out of here. You're out of here. You didn't have to drink right. Just go ahead, leave. We love you. Blessed. Be blessed. We thank you so much for your fearless commitment to stay when so many others left. But you go on home. Now give me the people who know how to drink right. Give me the people who've been tested and examined. Give me the people who've been tried by the word, hallelujah, and examined by God. And I'll take them and I'll defeat everything that has stood in our way. I'll be right at ground zero. If you want us to be a spectator, I like what Brother Hogan said the other night. He said, Christianity is not a spectator sport. Come on. Shortly thereafter or before, he said, I hate you. What, you know, talking to the people. But God said, I got to love my enemies. I mean, that's pretty radical stuff. That's why I say I've never aspired to such greatness and letting people know how bad they are with respect to sitting around hearing the word, not doing it. And you know, and I'm going to say this, and I'm just saying because I know many of you heard this. I don't fully agree with all of that, but I'm so excited about it, and I honor it, because I mean, I understand the frustration when you see how easy it is to do, and how glorious it is to be this and to do this, and this is what God's called us to do, and people just sitting around, you know, under the yoke. It's just intolerable. And I want it to become that to you about you, because it became that to me about me. You see that? I couldn't tolerate that. I never had to go through that dynamic, though. When the power of God got me, I never had a delay. I immediately went to the streets. I immediately did signs and wonders. I immediately set my heart to do miracles. I immediately set my life to live the life of Jesus. I immediately submit myself to the order of the church. I love the church. I love the apostles and prophets, evangelists, pastors. I love the anointing. I just gave myself to it. And maybe you didn't. Maybe somehow there was something messed up, some feelings or attitudes crossed in your life, and you didn't do that. Beautiful thing of it is Father allows us to just repent. Get cleansed, get it right, and now engage. Somebody said, oh, it's about submission. No, it ain't about love. It's about love. It's about captivated. It's about, my goodness, I get to be a part of this. That's what it's about.
I don't want nobody to be submitted to me. That's not even interesting. That's the way that people define it. Huh? I want people coming asking me a bunch of questions. I got better things to do, man. I got to buck somebody else. It has nothing to do with that. It has to do with where your heart's burning on fire with respect to those things that God's made available and where you can go and find them. Because when you're tugging on God, when somebody comes to me and they're tugging on God, I can feel it. I can feel they're tugging on God. They're just not just, they're not debriefing, blowing smoke, processing. They're pulling on God. I can feel it. I feel it. Oh, then the gift works, you see. Ha, hallelujah. Whew, that's good. I've always got time for that. I've always got time for that. I love that. That's what it's all about. You have to quit being human. You got to quit living like a mere person, born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And start living like a person who's been born in righteousness and being shaped in purity. Hallelujah. Being raised up in every way to fully manifest everything that belongs to the glory of God. Because I'm going to tell you right now, all creation groans right now, travailing to see the manifestation of these deliverers on Mount Zion. Or call them those who are walking in the Spirit and being led by the Spirit, the sons of God. Because that's what it's about. That's what Romans, I don't care what your favorite teacher said about Romans 8:21. Romans 8:14 through 17 told me what Romans 8:21 has to say. And Romans 8:29 puts a big underline under it. Get with the program. Everybody wants to put it off till later when we all get to heaven. It's now. Well, quit delaying then. Just quit delaying. Cast out devils, lay hands on the sick, raise the dead, start seeing people get saved. Right now. Any one of you can build what you can, we'll give you any, we got tons of rooms. You start building a ministry as long as it's submitted to the church, not some kind of thing that's weird. I'm not having weird. But when you're reaching the lost, not counseling a bunch of disgruntled people, that's nonsense. They need to repent. That's rebellion. Stinking rebellion. God's anger burns against it. And they'll burn in hell for their rebellion. You listen to me. I know exactly what I'm talking about. I know exactly where I'm speaking from. You get things submitted to God and His church. You do it God's way by the Holy Ghost. Otherwise, I'm telling you, you playing jeopardy with your life, making it up as you go. God's called, given us His word. It is absolute. It is absolutely essential. Nothing can be compromised. We must do it like He said it. And no making it up as somebody imagines it to be and their own ideas. We got enough rooms. You start reaching the lost and bring them in. Raise up people look just like you. That's what you want to go after. You want to go find people look just like you? We'll have a whole room of people just look just like you, but they're coming into the kingdom. Praise God. And then you just bring them on down into the bigger meeting. Come on. God wants to make you an effective soul winner. God has placed you in that chair for you to become an effective soul winner. Through signs and wonders and demonstration of the power of God with the end to reach souls. Come on now. And it ain't going to happen 10 at a time. It happens one at a time. And so you go after one and then maybe you lose one. You go after yourself another one. And before long, you'll have yourself some people that are going to stick around. And then there's going to be two. And then there's going to be three. And then there's going to be 10. But if you're not faithful, if you're unrighteous in a little, you're going to be unrighteous in a bunch. If you're righteous in a little, you'll be righteous in great things. Faithful too, so you can exchange that word. Faithful. You hear me? That's why you're sitting there. Hope, Pastor, you need to go out and do it. That's not what God's called me to do. He's called me to do other things. He's called me to preach in this context for you to bring them in, and I'll see them get established in the things of the Spirit. I'll see them get established in the ways of God. You go reach them. God purposed you to go reach them. You're going to have to get with this program. You have to get settled in your spirit what you're supposed to be doing. Because what it's going to do, it's going to begin to bring attention. You're going to begin to have to deal with the lack of anointings in your life, you see? And people don't want to deal with that. It takes an anointing to see somebody get saved. It takes an anointing to begin to minister to somebody and see them busting Christ. When I first started ministering to people, it didn't touch them that deeply. It was mostly head, but I kept at it. And then after a while, it went right to their heart. And it bust them up, and it's a captivating thing. And all you got to do is just get past your fear and get past your intimidation. What happens, it's a process. You begin to deal with your lack of anointing. And then we see the lack of anointing and they just give up because they just feel like a failure. Are you unfaithful? A little person, you have shown that that seed was planted in stony ground, because as soon as a little persecution came, you withered. You withered up and dried up. It shows right there that the seed wasn't put in good ground. And now you got to deal with the things about your own personal life, your attitudes. You got to deal with the areas of your life of where you lack, you don't have the anointing that maybe you thought you did. And that is the case for a lot of people. They think they got more anointing than they do. The anointing is truly tested when you are effectively able to do what God's called you to do. And when you sit in a church, when you're in a ministry, and you occupy a seat in a ministry, you're called to reach the lost. I'm called to reach the lost. But Father has me very focused on other things of ministry that consumes my time. Now, if Father had you focused on other things in ministry that consumed all your time in ministry, then maybe you would, it would be your responsibility then to have other foot soldiers that are going out there, effectively going after reaching lost. But you have already gone through that, because I guarantee you, God never places anybody into a seat of authority until they first begin to function the anointing to do the first works of reaching the lost. If you've never gone through that, if you've never gone through that training camp in the Holy Ghost, somebody said, would you please take us through training? The training is in the Holy Ghost. I'll give you all kinds of training. We'll have training Friday night again. We got training right now. We have training on Wednesday night. Then we'll have training on Friday night, okay? Now, we can't just be dry labbing it all the time, just training. Somebody got to go do some practice. But if you do it, and you risk it, you got to lay down your life. Somebody said it's painful, it hurts. Welcome to the fellowship of his sufferings. Welcome to bearing the reproach. It's a beautiful and wonderful thing. Go get used to it. It'll become very, very glorious. Because when people reject you, which rarely happens, and persecute you, which rarely happens, the comfort of the Holy Ghost will be explosive on a level that you've never experienced before. When men set you out of their company, slam the door and tell you get out of here, watch out, because you got right ready to have some fellowship like you never had with God in your life. Huh? When your mother and father forsake you, the Lord takes you up, kind of thing, you know. When you suffer that kind of persecution, boom, those around you in the world, the grace and the glory of God rests upon you. Hallelujah. You want to learn that. You get it. You need to set some goals for yourself. Where are you going to go in these goals? Are you going to take up and let God lay upon your heart souls? And then begin to give yourself to reaching one. Maybe go and picking them up. Maybe just calling them up. Just one person. Just like I'm saying, this girl. Calling, how you doing? I'm praying for you. Let's pray. Hey, let's get together. I've got time. I know the mothers are busy. Mothers are busy with their house. I know how busy Allie is and with the things that she's doing. But you know what? She's going to find times to reach the lost. We can always find ways to reach the lost. We can find ways to reach the lost. We can find ways to get people, touch people, bring them into the meeting. Because we're not living in a cave. Hello. And you say, well, I talk a lot of people about the Lord, but I don't reach anyone. Behold, that's the lack of the anointing in your life. The anointing is given to break the yoke, to break the yoke off the lost so that you can reach them and they'll come be set free. To your ministry. We want you to enjoy this. We're not putting no yoke on you. We want you to begin to understand the exploits of God. Because if you're afraid to do that, you're going to always, you'll be so afraid. You'll be paralyzed, curled up in a fetal position about raising someone from the dead. You're not ever going to go into the exploits. Huh? Nobody could imitate Wigglesworth. No one. No one dared to. Somebody had stomach cancer, he'd draw back and punch him in the stomach. How are you going to imitate that? He was just radical. He was, you know what that was? It was a display of that boldness. The more radical, bold people are, they grow into it. They mature into it. Why? Because they dealt with their lack of the anointing. They dealt with the things in their life that said, you can't do these works. and they got radical. They said, oh yeah, God is God. They got after it. You didn't have to do that. I'm going to tell you right now, dear people, the majority of you have never been through the tension. You've just not gone through the tension. You've never been in the tension of it. You backed away. God wanted to show you where your areas of need were, where he wanted to supply, and you didn't press in to have it. You let it be. Don't do that. You ain't going to ever have nothing. This is for the desperate. This is for the hungry. This is for the pastor. This is for those who can't live without it. And they just sitting around in church under the anointing as I'm ministering going, yeah, I can't live without it. No, it's the tension can't live without it. It's the challenge can't live without it. It's putting it to the test can't live without it. Hello. Amen. And the Lord make you to increase. And I want you to get a hold of this and abound in love. Because no matter where we look at this, we're going to find out that that is the key ingredient to stepping over into a place of receiving everything that God has and maturing in everything that God has and developing properly individually and collectively as a glorious church. It's absolutely essential. And I'm going to tell you right now, it's where the biggest part of the attack is. And the only thing that's getting in the way is your mind. And if you would start thinking the Word of God and take it, because see, if you think the Word of God, that is the mind of Christ. It's not some magical, esoterical moment of time where you have this particular instant of encounter and change. That happened at the new birth. It's now all of a sudden you have dealt with it. You've wrestled the things that come against you. You've cast them down. You've given yourself over into this, to this place of living by the Word. And you just keep, as you do it and as you give yourself to it, you become better and more effective at it to where that the mind of Christ is what you live in. The mind of the Spirit is what you live in. What are you doing? Living in the thoughts of the Word of God. You're living under the rule of the Word. And one of the most important things is that place of living and dwelling in love, that relationship place, because Satan's going to attack you in all kinds of imagination and all kinds of thoughts that are contrary to the ways of God. And if you're not trained in living in this wonderful thinking realm where your thoughts are governed by the Word of God, well, you know what? You're not going to remain in love. You're just not going to do it. But it's here, the essentialness of it. Listen. Increase and abound in love towards one another, towards all men, and towards all, even as we do towards you. Okay? Beautiful thing. Because Paul's going to give an example. Father, the leader always gives the example. Father gave the example. Jesus gave the example. Paul gave the example. Pastor's supposed to give the example. To the end. Listen, for this purpose. In other words, if you don't do this, you can't have this. If you don't do what was already said, you can't have that which is going to be said. You must abound in love if you're going to be stabbed, if you're going to have your hearts established, unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father at the coming of the Lord Jesus. Get it down with all his saints. Get it down. Get it down. If you're not willing to abound in love, you got to understand that that's why Satan's going to fight it so hard. That's why stuff's going to come at you right, left, and center. That's why there's going to be everybody with all their logical conclusions and every accusation that Satan can throw at you personally and everything he can stir up in the minds of people to come against this one thing because it is the main thing. And then you look over here in Ephesians chapter 3, and of course you hear me talk about Ephesians chapter 3 so much. You hear me talk about it so much that you should have memorized, right? To know. Go ahead. Complete it, 3:19. To know. Stop there. To know the love of Christ. Don't get carried away. Because we pass by it and just like, okay, to know. Wow, fullness of God. Wow, fullness of God. Oh, I love that fullness of God. But I don't have time to know the love of Christ. Because what he's saying is he's saying right there. Here, you know what he just said? He said, this is an experience. And everybody's got something to say against an experience. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, this is an experience. This is an encounter. Somebody says, I want that encounter. You give yourself to it. You give yourself to it. You participate with it. You come up against the challenges to where that you recognize, man, I'm not feeling love, I'm feeling hate. You know what? I'm not feeling love, I'm feeling strife. I'm not feeling love, I'm feeling an argument. I'm not feeling love, I'm getting out of here right now. I'm not feeling love, I'm done with you. I'm feeling tired of you. And most people go with the other, not the love. Why? What's going on? All that's taking place is what's really happening in your life is being revealed, and you don't want to step up and deal with it. You're seeing the lack. You're seeing the places where you've not been developed, where you've not been willing to go with the Holy Ghost, where you've not been willing to mature. You're seeing exactly right there why you can't move in the glory of God, why you can't participate with the glorious church. Because you know it's available. What did he say? He said, be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being so that you can be rooted and grounded and settled in love. Here it is again. And if you're rooted and grounded and settled in love by being strengthened by the Holy Ghost, wait, if anyone on him, guess what's going to happen? With all saints, you're going to know what every dimension of this is. It's a command of God. It's not some level. It's not something you attain. It's not something you earn. It's something you participate with and that you're willing to give yourself to, and you're willing to face the challenges, and you're willing to throw down everything contrary to the will and the word of God. It's that real. It's that practical.
You know, James got up and ministered after I got finished preaching on, I think it was Friday night, got up and ministered the next Saturday morning. He said, you know what? He said, I just so want to be able to live what we heard last night. And he said, I pastored long enough to realize that people hear this and they're excited about it, and by Tuesday, they're just gone. And the bottom line of it is, you're going to have to be willing to start thinking these things, thinking these thoughts. And he hit it right and he nailed it. I mean, just every pastor on the planet has the same problem in the Western world. People hear it, they're excited about it. Wow, there's some miracles, there's some signs and some wonders, but people just stuck. They continue to live their life the way they have, in a pattern, in a habit. It is a challenge to break patterns and to break habits and to quit behaving yourself in the way that you have behaved yourself, and recognize that spiritual growing up is a very real and necessary and essential thing. And it demands change that you got to be consecrated to. Get the cords, bind me to the horns of the altar so I don't move. Yes. Are you with me? Can you hear that? Do you hear what I'm saying? Can you be bound to the word? You're supposed to bind the word upon you. You're supposed to bind it upon your fingers, your hand, your arm. You're supposed to wear it as frontless. You're supposed to be bound to it. It's a covenant. You're supposed to be bound to the Spirit. I go bound in the Spirit. Under his authority, under his control. I've given my will over to do the will of the Father. If you're doing your will, people, hello, the light is shining on your life that you're not doing the will of the Father. You're doing your own will. Quit pretending. Deal with it. People just want to run and hide from the issue. They don't want to face it. I'd rather face it. I take the veil off and look in the mirror and go, wow! Woohoo! The glory! Are you listening to me? It's a beautiful thing. Come on now. Get the veil off. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Amen. Yeah. Somebody responded. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and there be filled with all the fullness of God. That's what Father wants for you. To increase and abound in love. Why? So that your hearts can be established. Unblameable before the Father, the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ with all of his saints. Now go to 1 John 4:16. And I mean, once again, you should know this verse of Scripture. I quote it so much. But somehow people fail to realize that this is the battlefield as well as the opportunity. How hard is it to be in love? Can you have enough force of your will to just continually live in love? Could you? Without the Holy Ghost, without being strengthened by the Spirit. I don't know. I think that people could be pretty generous. I think there's been models of people that are very sweet and generous and always kind. Mostly women. Very few men. But Papa's wanting us to do it by the Holy Ghost. And he's talking to us about a higher love. So he's not just talking to us about a human love. So when I was saying that, can somebody do it? I was talking about from the perspective of human love. Huh? Just being loving, loving everybody, never meeting a stranger kind of thing. But Father wants us to love like he loves. He wants a different kind of love, to know the love of Christ. See, that's the caveat, to know the love of Christ, to know God kind of love, the Jesus kind of love, Holy Ghost kind of love, which only the Holy Spirit can supply. Now he says in 1 John 4:16, are you there? To know and believe the love that God has for us. So you're going to have to let God be God. You're going to have to let God be God. Here you're going to have to begin to start believing what he said. You're going to have to believe that he's here. You're going to have to believe that he's here and that he's a rewarder. You got to believe that those things which he's commissioned us to do, he's empowered us to do. Also, he's not refusing us, we're refusing him. He's not resisting us, we're resisting him. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can everybody hear me here?
Yes.
Did you know that I'm talking to you right now about the most radical change in your life? I'm talking to you about everything in your life taking on some serious adjustment that this is going to affect, to start off with, your every minute. That if you were evaluating this, that your every minute is being impacted because you can see in your every minute something that was going on that didn't conform to this. And you're going to be, what's going to happen? You're going to deal with the fact of where you've not been walking in the Spirit, where you've not been living in the Spirit, where you've not been dependent upon the Holy Ghost, where you've not been acknowledging him, where you've not been letting him flood your soul, bathe you, pickle you. Whew. To know and believe the love that God has for us, God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. How easy. How easy to dwell in God. How easy. How easy. To dwell in God. Dwell in love. I mean, you'd think that everybody go, "Woo, I got it. Look at this. I know how to be made perfect. I know how to have the fullness of God. And I know how to dwell in God. All I got to do is stay in love." And I say, everybody's going to do it. No one does it. Oh, well, very few. So tell me, what's the problem? Those with the insight? Huh? Those with the counsel of the Lord? Just tell me, what's your problem? What's your problem here? Papa wants to show you where you're not dependent upon the Holy Ghost, where you're not living by the Spirit, where you're not walking as a son. If you're not walking as a son, how are you going to mature as a son? If you're not living by the Spirit, how are you going to mature in the things of the Spirit? Come on now. Because you're not willing to let the Word of God rule your mind and your thinking and be the evaluation of your action, of your deeds. You're not willing to think differently about yourself. You're not willing to let the Word of God change the way you think. If you let the Word of God change the way you think, it would change the way that you believe. And what you believe will change the way that you do things. It's really just that simple. It ain't any harder than this, dear people. We just got a problem dealing with demon spirits and influences that we let in as friends when they are foes, agreeing with things that are wrong and making them right and justifying them in our own mind and thinking. By wrong action and behavior, by decisions, we opened up doors that came in and deceived us. You hear me now?
Yes.
Because I'm not talking to people on the web. I didn't even know the web was going. I'm really talking to you. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Herein is our love made perfect. I was in a meeting the other day, and I said, how many of you want to know how to have perfect love? Three people raised their hand. Why? Because the rest of them, it's just a manifestation. Nobody even believes that you can. It's a manifestation. People say, "Oh, no, I was just tired. Oh, I really didn't hear you." It is a spiritual manifestation of the state of your life. The lack of response, the lack of passion, the lack of pursuit. I hope you get it so you start hollering out. Huh? You need to start hollering out. I mean, when it comes, when there's moments of opportunity to identify yourself with God, to have those things that God declares, that to say that it's yours, you need to start hollering out to identify who you are of, what spirit you are of. Hallelujah. Because something's been running some interference in your life. Herein is our love made perfect. How important is that? So that we may have boldness. So that we may have boldness. And I'm not just on the day of judgment, that we may have boldness to begin to move in faith. What did the apostle say? Lord, stretch forth your hand and grant signs and wonders by your holy child Jesus, so that we can have boldness. Huh? Is really what it came down to. Without boldness, you can't do nothing in God. And it's not bold about what you can do. It's bold about God is right here, right now, right with me. And all I'm doing is being obedient servant and carrying out his will as I grab this person out of this coffin. Or if I command this deaf person to speak. This mute person to speak, deaf person to hear, blind person to see. And it's a realm of anointing. It's not just a realm, because when you do that, that boldness comes from the Holy Ghost. It's the Holy Ghost boldness. It's you're not even self-conscious anymore. It's the Holy Ghost boldness. It is a communion with the Holy Ghost that produces the boldness to begin with, and then it's that realm of that anointing that you're in that causes the cure to come. Look how simple it is. You just got to quit being you. Start being Jesus.
Amen.
You can be you all by you, but you got to be, the only way you can be Jesus is by the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
You can be you all by you. You don't need no help to be you. You all by yourself at any time, any place, anywhere, easy. But to be Jesus, that's by the Holy Ghost. And I'm dead. I don't no longer live. Jesus lives. And I don't even have the right to be me. And I'll tell you right now, you don't have the right to be you. And the only way you're going to ever learn not to be you is to live by the Word of God, be ruled by the Word of God, and come under the strict orders of the Word of God. And until you're willing to do that, and when you're willing to do that, my goodness, you honor the church. You honor the governorship of the church. You believe in apostles and prophets and teachers. You believe in apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. You believe in the government of the church. You believe in the rule of God's house. You believe in the ministry of the Holy Ghost through men to perfect you. And quit doing your own stuff, making it up as you go. That ain't. You just being creative, a creative thinker, and participating with a heavenly vision. It's doing your own thing in somebody else's house. Why don't you ask permission before you open up the fridge? You know what I'm saying? Then
yes.
Pop the lid off the milk and start drinking right out the jug. Look, we got glasses in the cupboard. I mean, it's one thing if we just open up the fridge. It's another thing if we start drinking the milk right out of the jug that we were going to be all drinking out of. We pour it into glasses. That's just rude. It's just wrong. It's undisciplined minds. It's undisciplined spirits. It's people who've never been governed by the Word. They govern by themselves. They don't do the will of the Father. They do their own will and say, God, you're going to have to be happy with it because I'm really enjoying this. And ain't I creative? Be imaginative and creative with the Word of God, not your ideas. Hello. Amen. Submit yourself to God and watch what will happen.
Amen.
The devil will run in terror.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't that good news?
Yes.
And then, of course, I'm going to give you another verse of scripture that one of you should be able to quote, because I give it to you so often you can't leave this church and say you didn't get taught the Word. I'm telling you right now, if I ever sit in one of your meetings and hear something, you know, some crazy doctrine and don't feel the anointing, I'm just going to get up and pick up a chair and throw it through the window and walk out. as a display of protest against the meeting. Because it wouldn't be right. I mean, I'm going to just tell you right now, what I'm doing is a gift. And it can be imparted. And you can catch it. And you can catch it.
Yes.
So there's no reason for you not to be without it unless you're not connected. And you're not connected because something's wrong with your love. When something's wrong with your love, everything's messed up. And you can have all faith to move mountains. And if you have love, do not have love, it profits you nothing. What are we talking about in that profit? Heaven. 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 You can speak with the tongues of men and angels. Have not love, profits you nothing. It's tinkling cymbals, sound of brass. It's nothing in God's ears. Profits you nothing. This love, I'm going to tell you right now, people. You have to understand that Jesus put this as the highest. He said this is the highest declaration of the witness that we are his disciples. On a level said, if they don't have it, like I'm showing it to you, don't even believe them. Don't even believe them. They're not mine. They don't. They're of another spirit. They of another gospel. They of another Jesus. He's basically saying that in John 13. It's true in John 15 as well. So we got to understand the importance of it. And then we need to be fit and equipped to deal with the battles that come out against us to try to stop us. And then all the slander and accusation, deception of the devil that intermingles with it. And then his deceiving power that comes on top, that makes you justified for your demonic attitude. He would do that, though, you know. He'd justify anybody that acts like him. So look at that. Look at this verse of Scripture. Why are you supposed to be praying in the Holy Ghost anyways? When you're praying in the Holy Ghost, what's happening? God's talking through you. Did you know that? Because they speak as the Holy Ghost gave utterance. Who's the Holy Ghost? Pretty simple, ain't it? You got your proof text, God talking through you. I mean, come on, it's just, hallelujah. My spirit prays, but my spirit's joined unto the Lord. And understand, it's God talking through me. Oh, that's just your spirit praying. That's God. That's God. She wants to interpret tongues. It's just all over. It's just all over. You just have to learn how to move in the. See, you got to get in love, you see. And love casts out all fear. And if you're in love, you're so relaxed now. And that same inspiration that caused the tongues come out, same inspiration with the language that everybody can understand. And just intermingles. The other night I was ministering in a place and I was like 3-4 syllables in tongues and then 3-4 words in the English language, and it was just all integrated. It was weaved together as a tapestry, because what the Lord wanted to show those people is it's the same realm. The interpretation of the tongues is in the same realm as the tongue itself. They're intermingled. It comes out of the same inspiration. Hallelujah. But it's just these things are working in the realm of love. You can't do that. You'll be feel all awkward and self-conscious and what people are thinking, all trembly and fearful. Because the Holy Ghost is going to give you the kind of boldness that moves the self-conscious out of the way. You don't care anymore. You're so drunk in the Holy Ghost, you don't even care. Woo-hoo! You know, it's like, you know, you don't even care if you're howling at the moon kind of thing, you know. You don't even care. You just caught away in glory, and it's beautiful because you just raptured in the love of the Papa, love of the Father. So you're looking at with me. You're looking at me. You're looking with me at Jude chapter 1, verse 20. Whew. Huh? Hallelujah. Whew. Praise the name of the Lord. Whew. Huh? Whew. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hoo, hoo, hoo. Jesus. Hallelujah. What does it say? Huh? What does it say? It says build yourself. What does that mean? Build yourself up. That's not about getting bold. That's talking about getting confident. That's talking about getting strong. Let's talk about getting certain. That's talking about getting able. That's talking about getting ready. Huh? Getting fit. Getting equipped. Hallelujah. Everything get out of the way because I'm bringing this thing down right now. And everything's going to change. I mean, just knowing. Why? Because it isn't about you. It's about who God is. You let God be God and you understand who you are and who he is with you and in you. Who am I?
I am, my whole life is all about Jesus, so that I say, I no longer live. For me to live is Christ. I am what I am by this grace of God. This outworking of the power of the new creation. I'm not mingled in it anymore. I'm not living under my dictates. I'm not living under my culture. I'm not living under the things that everybody said about me and that I believe about myself. I know myself after the Spirit. And now I'm so filled with the Holy Ghost that all I know is the Word of God, and to do the things that God said to do and boldly do them. Build yourself up. Build yourself up in your... What's that? Because we're talking about the faith of God there, you see. We're not just talking about some sacred religious belief. We're talking about that which belongs to God. This is God's faith. This is the faith of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Shatoria. Shatoria. Shatoria Samaya. That thing's healed up. You know that. Anyways. No poisoning. Making none. Any headway at all. Hallelujah. And don't let God down tonight. I just thought that was the best ever. That was the best ever. Because you can watch, one of the things that was so beautiful to me when I was watching, extraordinary miracles. Extraordinary miracles where big swelling growths were going down right there. Where just radical things happening. Twisted people, cancer, just amazing crippled situations being completely made whole before your eyes. And then there steps up somebody who's got a deaf ear and they're having problem believing in the midst of all that miracle. What's the problem really? The love. The love. The thought life. It's been unfiltered. They've constantly allowed themselves to be beaten down and intimidated by all the lies of the enemy, to live and be under the influence of all the problems and all the relationship issues and etc. Build up yourself in the most holy faith, praying in that. And what's going to happen? What's going to happen? What will happen as a result? You will keep yourself in the love of God. See? Get over here. Get over here. See? Huh? I don't go anywhere without the Holy Ghost. I don't do anything without Basatevedi. I don't care where I'm going. I'm praying in the Holy Ghost first. I'm praying the Holy Ghost before I get there. I don't care what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna pray in the Holy Ghost before I get there. If it's a walk around the block, I'm getting ready. I'm keeping myself in the love of God. I'm keeping building myself up. I'm not gonna speak out of myself. I'm not gonna do it out of my own thinking and out of my own way. I'm not gonna come on, listen to me, people. Huh? Am I the only person that walks in the building praying in the Holy Ghost? I need to talk to somebody who's greeting. And just ask, how many people walk in like me? Because I walk in every day. You will never see me walk through the doors of this building. Since the doors of this building have existed, since this church has existed, that's how I come in, that's how I go out. I am an example. I am a model of the truth. I do the word of God. Hallelujah. People are without excuse not to obey God. When you got the word of God telling you to do it and somebody showing you by example, come on, people. Come on. That's just stubbornness, man. That's just high-mindedness. It's self-willed. It's you being you and doing, living in an isolated whatever it is that you live in that I'm glad I'm not in. Instead of stepping out into the wide, big, wide world of God. Huh? You hear me? Yeah. Stepping out into the big, open display of His power and glory. Communion with the Holy Ghost. Huh? Walking in the Spirit and enjoying and all the wonderful things that heaven has to give. I want everybody to stand with me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And I'm just so blessed. I'm just so blessed with it. Hallelujah. I'm so blessed with the musicians. I could sing all night half the time. But there's something far more than just singing. I want worship. I want us to go after worship. out of the realms of the Holy Ghost on another level. I mean, I don't want to have to. It's just like receiving the offering. Don't receive the offering until people are in the anointing, man. It takes the whole meeting. It might be the same thing. Don't even do any worship till everybody's in the anointing. It takes the whole meeting. But it's not supposed to be that way. Not if we're going to be the glorious church. You got to get passionate about function flowing in the anointing. You can't come in here with all your baggage. The lost can come in with their baggage. The demon-possessed can come in with their baggage. The oppressed who don't know how to walk this walk in the Spirit can come in with their baggage. But you can't, because you're supposed to be a member in the body of Christ with the manifestation of the Spirit in your life. Function in the glorious church, because you dedicated. You so want to see the glorious church. You're sitting around going, oh, man, I wish I could find the glorious church. You get there, you'll mess it up like that. You can't go. You'd mess it up. You get there and be a spectator. You see what I'm saying? You got to be passionate right now about being a part of the glorious church and recognizing, I can't do that. I cannot be a big part of being a part of the body of Christ or being a member in the body of Christ is oneness. And you can't have oneness with each other without having oneness with them. That they may be one in us. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, this is what we're going to do. Amen. And people are going to get themselves right around here. Amen. And people, listen, there's things we're doing in this ministry, and we'll let people know what we agree with. You can't just come do whatever you want to do in here. That's a violation. Because none of us are doing what we want to do in here of ourselves. We want to do what God the Holy Ghost wants to do in here. We can't be walking all over the thing. Hallelujah. So, well, I had a good idea. Well, then you need to run it by somebody who's in charge. You know what I'm telling you? And we just, you know, we want it. We just are so blessed. I'm so blessed with what I've seen. Just like right here, I'm seeing these new flowers. That's a blessing. New baskets. I mean, those baskets that we had there have been since Methuselah. They survived the flood. Those other baskets, they survived the flood. They actually miraculously have held together. It's just like, it was just like the shoes in the wilderness. It's a miracle that they eat. As many people who stood in those baskets over the year. Praise the Lord. I mean, I just love seeing people taking care of the house of God. And the more that you begin to understand this, the more you understand that your behavior and your action as a manifestation of the impacts that God is having on your life and the things that you're willing to cooperate and participate with, the more you're going to begin to deal with the reality of your needs and your issues. Because the reality of this, dear people, is you can have issues and not know it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we love you. And we want you to get over your issues. Hallelujah. And start having the issue of life. Hallelujah. Keeping your heart with all diligence. Hallelujah. For out of it proceeds the issues. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whew. Mighty God. Well, dear people, we love you. I just want you to know it's not hard. It's not hard. And, you know, it's really not that difficult. It's not difficult at all. It's about time that people find a realm of prayer where there's a brightness and a smile on their face rather than a sense of agony that somebody's pinching their toe off. Because that doesn't look beautiful to the world or anybody else. No one says that it looks amazing. No one's going, wow, those guys got something. They're going to... Let's not do it our way. Let's not do it our way. Let's not make it up. Let's not have it in the human realm. Let's have it in a divine realm. So what song are we going to do? I want to worship just a little bit, okay? Jesus.
Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is
musicians, come on up.
Consuming fire.
Our God
is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming. Our God is a consuming fire.
Our God is a consuming fire.
Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God.
Say your presence is life to me. Lord, your mercy rushes over me. Your love, your love fills my being. Your love fills every part of me. Oh, your love fills my being. Oh, your the floods of rain. Your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Your presence, Lord. The floods of the rain, your presence is like fire, it's like water, it's like the floods of rain.